Good evening, everyone. This is a continuation of the Board of Selectmen meeting for Tuesday, December 6, 2016. Next up, the Pledge of Allegiance, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to its republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We began this evening in executive session to talk about contract negotiations, litigation, and real property. Next up is the public forum. Actually, we could probably come back to that at 6:45 in case we are running a couple minutes early here. So why don't we go to the consent agenda, which is item number 3. We have a few items on the consent agenda. The first is some minutes from 11/22/16. The second is a very generous gift of $2,500 from Unibank for the Hockington Public Library. The third is two marathon fund requests, one for $1,625 for purchasing 24 regular and 3 goalie bags for the Hockington High School varsity boys ice hockey team. And the second is $2,125 for some bags and jerseys for the Hockington High School girls hockey team. Anybody want to make a motion to approve the consent agenda, or does anyone want to break any items out?
Could we break out number 3, please?
Number 3, marathon fund request, broken out. That leaves items 1 and 2.
Motion to approve 1 and 2.
We have a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Mr. Tedstone. Any discussion? All those in favor? Aye. Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carries. Thank you. Mr. Sestari.
I'm just trying to look at the marathon fund records. Seems like the requests for the hockey team come through pretty regularly, and I'm just trying to figure out what the last request was for them.
I think it is an annual request of sorts. I think the kids might keep those bags.
Really?
I don't know. I shouldn't speculate, I guess.
Yeah. It's tough to really tell from this because, well, A, at least on my copy, half the lettering is cut off.
Perhaps that's intentional.
And then the
I'm kidding.
And the debits seem, at times, it's just for Tri-Valley Sports, so it doesn't really say what the request was or the group was.
Yeah.
I don't know if you have any better records over there, Mr. Camallo?
No, I do not at this point.
Any concerns, Mr. Camallo, from your vantage point?
Interesting enough, the request from the for the hockey team has been on the agenda, I think perhaps the last 3 or 4 years, and every time the board has had an extended discussion on the request. And by now, I believe that the marathon fund is pretty much aware of the board's expectations and how the funds are applied, and that they have forwarded this request with the understanding that the request meets the expectations of the board.
Okay.
But I don't have the specific answers to Sestari's questions.
Yeah, I guess slightly apart from the request, as I'm looking at the account activity on the marathon fund, I see a lot of activity with no description of what the purpose is, and it's activity where there's payment to, for example, Town of Shrewsbury, Town of Bellingham, Town of Southbridge, Town of Framingham. Why would that be?
Isn't that the funds that are used for officers and other deployments during the marathon itself?
No, this fund is used for paying for athletics-related activities in town. I can check with finance for more details. I'm sure they do have the detailed description of the accounts and the payments.
That's a separate request, mm-hmm. And I don't want to hold up these particular requests necessarily. I trust that you're saying that this has been on for a couple of years, and it keeps getting pushed out from one year to another. I don't have any urgency on my part to hold this request off, but if we could get more information on that account, that would be great.
I'd be interested to hear what those other town expenses are then. I thought the Marathon Fund account, not the committee, but the account, takes all that money in from the BAA, spends it out or expends it where it needs to go based on the expenses coming from the marathon, and then the balance is what the Marathon Fund Committee has at their disposal to promote youth activities in the community. So let's just clarify that.
We'll clarify.
Because that would that would be logical based on your observations of those different communities.
Yeah. In fact, unfortunately, I'm having problems pulling up the attachment. The expectation is that the board receives information on the expenditures related to the scholarships that are approved through, or the funding requests that are approved through the Marathon Fund. That's above and beyond what the town pays to other towns.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
So on the next page, for under authorizations outstanding, I am seeing more detail, and I do have all the lettering, so I can actually read it. I see in October 2015, so a year ago, Filler Ice gets $1,500. If we go back a little bit further, in October of 2014, Friends of Hiller Hockey gets close to $1,300. Mm-hmm. If we go back a little bit further, now we go back two more years to Friends of Hiller Hockey, and they get a little over $1,700. So, you know, I mean, I don't know. I don't want to take the authority or the job of the people on this committee, but it seems to me like we've got, you know, some regulars that come back, you know, year over year. I don't know that it's the case where kids get to keep the bags.
I don't know. If
it is the case, personally, you know, I don't know the need for that. But whatever it is, it seems like year after year, this is kind of, there's some portion that's being directed to the same group. And we need to make sure that all the other groups know that, you know, there's something out there so that others can make requests too. Or you know, we need to start looking closer at this.
Okay.
Because this year is going to be what, the request total between the two?
The two teams, $1,600, about $3,500 bucks, $3,600.
Yeah. So, you know, it's...
It isn't. They have been an annual request, and I think it's been pretty transparent. I don't have anyone who plays hockey, so I don't know the details. Anything else in terms of... So, with that, any other discussion on item three? So, you want to make a motion, or you want someone else to make a motion?
I'm not making the motion.
Okay.
Motion to approve.
Okay, motion to approve item number three on the consent agenda for items one and two for funding for various hockey teams.
Second it.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Nay.
One opposed? It passes 3-1. Thank you. Okay, with that, let's go back to item number two now, since we are a little... ahead of schedule. That's a good thing. Let's try and keep it that way. Item two is our public forum. Anyone here this evening that would like to address the board and share ideas, opinions, or ask questions regarding their town government? Yes, sir, if you would kindly introduce yourself to those that don't know you.
Mr. Chairman, fellow members, I'm Bob Levinson, 13 Smith Road. And just wanted to get a thought out there. I didn't want it to die of loneliness. I wanted to share it with the board that I think there's a consensus in town, I know among the committee, is all about the value of volunteers in the town. And I know there's kind of periodic recognition of people, and I just thought it might be helpful to have some type of regular forum or mechanism to recognize volunteers quarterly, monthly, or something like that, because It stays on the agenda. It can encourage volunteerism, and I think it's nice to just recommend people. So I just want to throw that out there.
Bob knows of what he speaks. He's the former chair of the Personnel Committee here in town and has been very active in the community for a long time. And I think it's an excellent idea. And we really don't have a regular volunteer recognition program, do we? Mr. Kamal, have we, over the years, has that come and gone, or has that not been on the forefront?
I think through the chair, Bob raises a very good suggestion. We do not have a formal recognition process other than acknowledging volunteers when they come on board and when they leave boards.
Yeah, okay. It's an excellent suggestion, and I'm sure that we'll record the suggestion. I would encourage us to record the suggestion, and let's try and come up with some kind of program, like on a quarterly basis or something like that, to see how it would work.
Right.
It's a great idea.
It's a great idea as well.
Okay.
Thank you, Bob.
Thank you.
Appreciate it very much. Anybody else here tonight to share in their ideas or opinions with the Board of Selectmen? Seeing no other takers at this time. Oh, wait.
All right.
We do have some gentlemen here. Hi, guys.
How are you?
Hi.
Well, how are you?
Good, thank you. How are you?
Good, good. You want to introduce yourselves and let us know what you're here to discuss?
All right. My name is Alex Wojak.
And I'm Matt Dempsey.
We're class officers from the class of 2019 here at Hoppington High School. Here today, I know you guys are going to be discussing who gets the marathon bids here in town, and we would just like to please ask you to consider our bid. The bid would help fund class events that would not only help unite the group by being fun and enjoyable, but by also, funding things for school pride events that bring people together. So what we ask is that you please consider our bid, as it will make a huge impact on our funds. Unlike some, bigger charities around town, this is a smaller one of just a couple people in a room once a week. So this really means a lot for us. So thank you for your time.
Thank
Anything
you.
Else?
I think you covered it.
All right.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you very much, guys.
Later on our agenda this evening, so you may want to stick around if possible. We may have questions at that time. Thank you. Anybody else? Okay. With that, we'll move on to item number 4 on the agenda, which we are a few minutes early for, but I think we have the key player here with us. I don't see why we probably couldn't tackle that early, unless we want to jump ahead a little bit and take care of some administrative work for a few minutes. Why don't we do that, actually? Let's jump to item number 11 and talk board liaison reports, board invites that might be outstanding, and things of that nature. Mr. Sestari, anything to report?
Yeah, I've been to Charter Review Committee meetings.
Really?
They're going to be coming in tonight at about 7 o'clock to update you and make a request for a special town meeting. But no, in all seriousness, the committee's been very busy over the last, just about over the last year or so, but especially in the last couple of months. And, every time I go to the meeting, and especially the days leading up to the meeting and then the days trailing the meeting, it amazes me how much time and effort Pam is putting into this. But the charter has been gone through with a fine-tooth comb. I think people can feel rest assured of that. And we are getting ready for a public forum tomorrow night, and people will be able to see some of the ideas that the committee has come up with on ways that we think the charter can improve in moving the town in the direction that that we think the town wants to move. And then we're looking to open up the warrant for a special town meeting so that the rubber can really meet the road, and people will decide for themselves whether they agree with the recommendations or not. So
okay. Any other liaison reports?
Nope.
Mr. Catino.
Nothing to report.
Okay. Mr. Tedstone.
Nope. I spoke with the Keefe Tech School Committee. I'm the liaison for them, and I've got on their agenda, so I'm going to I mean, I got their agenda, so I'm going to get to one of their meetings. And we had an elementary school building committee meeting last night, which I was not able to attend. And all the other liaisons that I'm on are hitting their stride.
Okay. I have a couple. I've been able to attend several, as I mentioned before, of the school committee budget meetings. Again, last week there was one. And I continue to watch very closely what's going on with the school committee as they prepare their budget and the level of detail and debate that they have internally, which I think is very healthy. So we'll be getting more information from them in the coming weeks and months. But myself, I continue to go. Mr. Call has been to several, and we'll keep that up right through December. Speaking of meetings, there's one every week they're doing in December. The other is the Fields subcommittee or study group that the school committee put together that I'm a liaison to, appointed by us, but it's a school committee body. I missed the meeting last night, admittedly. I just didn't see it on my phone because it was further down in the day, but I know they're working hard to try and come up with some recommendations, and I'll get to the next meeting they're having, which is a public forum. Well, they set a date for the public forum. The next meeting is coming up next Monday. Those are my two at this time. All good? Okay, so with that, will any other invites? I'm sorry, we didn't cover that part. Any invites out there that we need to be aware of?
Yeah, there are a couple. The first, next Tuesday, is the Chamber of Commerce holiday party. Board members are invited to attend. Notably, the Chamber will be recognizing a former chief clerk for his extended service to the community.
Okay.
There's also the Maya annual business meeting and luncheon, January 21st, next year.
Are you going to be attending that?
Lane might be. No, I'm not.
Lane might be. Okay. Yeah. So is anybody interested in the Maya event coming up in January?
Talk offline.
Get with Mr. Follow on that. And then as far as the chamber meeting, I think that's the holiday party to honor Chief Clark in the road race. It's the Timlin road race. Who can attend that? I have a conflict brewing with that next Tuesday evening. So Mr. Catino, anybody else?
I might be able to get there after dinner.
Okay, Mr. Sestari. I don't know if Mrs. Wright was planning on attending or not, but if we had two or three members, that would be great.
Okay.
All right, so with that, let's go back now to item number four on the agenda, which is the Charter Review Committee update and special town meeting. This is an action item for the Board of Selectmen tonight. Possible action item. You never know if we're going to take action or not. Fingers crossed by some. Pam, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have to thank Todd a lot because he took a lot off of my speech that I had to give to you guys. But I wanted to give you a slight update on the process, some of our significant changes that we're proposing, and a walkthrough of the request for a special town meeting date. We've had actually 19 public meetings since we started meeting last January. We've reviewed the current charter, sought input from towns, boards, and committees and department heads, analyzed 17 benchmark communities with similar demographics, held a public forum in September to gather input from residents, and discussed recommendations to be made with regards to the charter. Our committee has drafted a proposed charter, which is published on the town website and is available in the town clerk's office, and will be hosting a second public forum tomorrow night at the Senior Center at 7 p.m. Some of our proposals are mostly housekeeping in nature, organizing sections of the charter for better grouping, omitting sections that are no longer needed or duplicated in nature, and ensuring administrative orders and special acts are incorporated into the charter. We do have three significant changes that we are recommending based on much thought, analysis, and discussion. The first is the change to the town clerk from elected to appointed by the Board of Selectmen. The second is to standardize the reporting structure for town employees. And the third is to streamline the budget schedule and warrant process. And I can go into those if you would like, or let me know.
Why don't you go into them from 30,000 feet down to 20 and just kind of stay right there. But let's go into them a little bit each. Sure.
Okay. For the town clerk, we evaluated the benefits of both an elected and appointed position. The committee unanimously felt the town clerk should be appointed, but also recognized the unique nature of the position in town hall. As such, felt oversight by the Board of Selectmen, similar to the town manager, fire chief, and police chief, would be preferred. The town clerk's responsibilities would not change and from current practice, and no appointment shall become effective prior to the 2019 annual town election, which coincides with the end of the current town clerk's term, unless a vacancy occurs prior to that date.
Okay, thank you.
With regard to the standardized reporting structure, this relates to five areas: appointment, supervision, goal setting, evaluation, and discipline. After input from all impacted boards and discussion by the committee, we recommended a consistent reporting structure should be considered for town planner, library director, park rec director, board of health agent, and conservation commissioner. Each board or commission will still have appointing authority, and goal setting will happen with the full input and approval of the board of commission or commission in an open meeting. The change occurs in the day-to-day supervision, which will now be completed by the town manager, consistent with programmatic policy direction from the employee's appointing authority. The employee would continue to interact with the corresponding board or commission when such public body meets. Evaluation would be by the town manager with input from the individual board members, which does not necessarily require an open meeting. Part of this is to ensure all town employees receive an evaluation annually. Discipline would be by the town manager, subject to the right of the employee to appeal any decision to the appointing authority. This will allow for all town employees to be treated fairly and consistently, held to the same standards, offered the same working condition, and also retain the authority of the appointing board or commission.
Okay.
Finally, the committee seeks to streamline the budget schedule and warrant process. The same deliverables as are found in the current charter remain without due dates attached to them within the charter itself. The town manager will establish and issue a budget schedule no later than October 1st with agreement from the Board of Selectmen, School Committee, and Appropriation Committee, identifying these deliverable dates. This allows more flexibility for meeting the ultimate deadline of annual town meeting and the preparation of an annual Appropriation Committee report 14 days prior to annual town meeting. This report shall include recommendations and detailed explanations of all financial articles. The additional change of closing the warrant 90 days rather than 60 days before annual town meeting should also allow for better preparation of the warrant articles and motions document. The initiation of warrant articles remains unchanged at this time. Finally, recognizing the need to more carefully plan and monitor capital improvements across the town, the capital improvements program shall be designed to address unmet long-term, long-range needs and to implement the capital goals and objectives of the town, and shall include all town activities, all town departments, including the school department, and all enterprise funds. This 10-year plan will be updated annually and shall include cost estimates, potential methods of financing, and recommended time schedules for each improvement, as well as the estimated annual cost of operating and maintaining each facility and item of major equipment involved. The committee understands this is a guideline and issues may arise that will require changes between annual reviews of the plan. So the committee will analyze the input received at its public forum tomorrow evening and believes it's in a good position to bring forward a proposed charter amendment for town meeting vote. To be effective, the charter amendment must be accepted by 2/3 majority vote at town meeting, approved by the Attorney General, and adopted by a simple majority of the voters at the next annual town election. Only after the Attorney General has approved the charter, a 4-week process, may be placed as a ballot question on the annual town election. In order to minimize the time period between a town meeting vote and annual town election, the committee would respectfully request that the Board Selectmen set a date for special town meeting of January 30th, 2017. We discussed this date at our last meeting, working backwards from the deadline of April 10th, 2017, to file the ballot question. At least 4 weeks are needed prior to that for Attorney General review, which puts us in the midst of the Board of Selectmen budget hearings, February school vacation week, and hopefully the Super Bowl for the home team.
It's not around the World Series.
A date of January 30th for special town meeting would need the following. The Board of Selectmen would sign and post a warrant no later than January 13, 2017, which is 10 business days prior to special town meeting, as the 16th is a holiday. The warrant would close on the 10th of January. The Board of Selectmen would cause notice of warrant to be published on December 23rd. The warrant must be open for 10 days, and there are two holidays, the 26th of December and the 2nd of January, in this date range. And then tonight, hopefully, you'll set a date. For legal counsel, the Board of Selectmen can set a date and then, at a point later, cause the notice of the special town meeting to be published, thereby opening the warrant at that time. Our committee greatly appreciates your assistance in this matter.
Excellent. Thank you very much. So without debating, I think, the specifics of the three sort of major broad-based changes suggested, does anybody have any questions about the content of the presentation? Forget the town meeting piece for a sec.
I do. On the second part, who were the people that you're, what were the group that was library?
Library director, town planner, Parks and Rec director, Board of Health agent, and Conservation Administrator or Commissioner. I'm not sure what is Commissioner. Administrator?
Administrator.
Dang, we took that off the website, I thought.
Conservation Commission Administrator. Anything else? Mr. Catino?
I'm all set.
Mr. Sistar?
I don't have any questions, but seeing our new moderator in the audience, I'm just glad that he's going to have an easy one to open up with here. Just one article, you can zip right through it, right?
And no passion. One article and no passion. anything else?
No.
Okay, so great presentation. Thank you for the background. Just one thought, and some people have said, well, why are we doing any of this? Because the charter we have today says that we do this. So what we adopted 10 years ago, and it said, 10 years out, we will review the charter, we will establish the charter review commission, and we will go through, how's it going? And then put some ideas on the table to tweak it. Forgetting the specifics and the tweaks suggested, I think you guys have done a great job. And I know it's been a ton of work, and we really appreciate it very much. The whole community does, so thank you very, very much. So
just a note, I think it was from town council and his experience in dealing with this in other communities. He's estimating that these three proposals would probably take 2 to 3 nights to get through in town.
Okay. So we have a special town meeting request before us. The special town meeting request date that is before us of January 30th.
Which is a Monday.
Beginning of Monday, has been reviewed by town council and would be in line with what we need to do for special town meeting, would be in line with what we need to do between now and then to post it and get it all set up in that regard, but also in line with what needs to happen after special town meeting, assuming there's some form of approval process during town meeting to put this on the ballot at the regular annual town election. Ballot election, not regular town meeting, but
right.
Ballot election.
Correct.
Right? So does everybody sort of get that sequence? Mr. Kamalo.
Mr. Chair.
And he leans into the microphone. I know he wants to say something.
I want to attack Mr. Hare. Mr. Chair, it may be helpful for the board to build a consensus around the need for the special town meeting. Is the first step before establishing date. I know the need is obvious, but it's always helpful for discussions to cover that topic.
Okay. So, I think just the fact that our current charter requires that we do this and do it in an organized manner as laid out by our current charter, I think kind of highlights what that need is. Having been around since the charter was put in place before, and after the charter's been put in place, I think we're doing great as a community, and I think a lot of people would acknowledge that. We've got some rough spots that I think a lot of people would acknowledge too. And I think the charter review process that we've been going through, others more so than myself anyway, is necessary, and I think it's good. It's healthy for any organization to revisit how it's doing and how it's set up and how it's structured. I mean, it happens in private business every day. So I think calling a special town meeting so that we can focus on this very important question of how we govern ourselves is a very legitimate reason to have a special town meeting. And given the possibility that on a couple of nights, rolling that into a regular annual town meeting, I think would be very frustrating for an awful lot of people, including those sitting here tonight and everybody in the room that's concerned about, you know, how we do things. That's my two cents. Anybody else? Everybody good? So with that, I do think there is an absolute need for a special town meeting. I'm not doing this at any other or during a regular town meeting. I don't know. In fact, I'd encourage perhaps the moderator, if you would be so kind as to join us for a second. Do you have any thoughts on the special town meeting versus an annual town meeting, Mr. Garabedian?
I think with the type of schedule that's laid out, in order to coordinate this with the regular town election, the date that the Charter Review Committee has suggested is the appropriate date, you know, to get it lined up for a regular election without the need for a special election. I think it makes all the sense in the world to try to get this done during that time in late January, weather permitting, of course.
Point of clarification, it has to happen at an annual town election. So even if you waited to the annual town meeting to hold this, mm-hmm. you would have to wait till the May 2018 annual town election to vote upon it if it's successful.
Which is outside the intent of the charter review process that's in our current charter. The intent, I don't think it's outside the hard rules because I don't think it really spells that out, but the intent is a 10-year review and then adjustment in that fiscal year, if you will. Right? You agree with that?
As much as we can measure intent from a document, but yeah.
There's a lot of debate about the intent of documents. We're not going to do that here. Okay. So I guess one other comment that I would put out there, and I think this kind of goes to my colleagues probably more than anybody in the room, this special town meeting, if we vote to do it, is for the charter review. And when we open the warrant for the special town meeting, ideally it would be for the charter review. And given the fact that town council is suggesting that this could go on for a couple of nights, and we're in a sort of macro 10,000-foot view of how we govern and fine-tuning our local government, adding additional articles to a special town meeting called for the purpose of the charter review as its primary focus, I think would be, I don't think that would help the process.
I don't think it would help whatever cause either, coming after people have been there for three nights, you know, expressing their desires, even though they may be counter to their neighbors, and they've been going through that for, you know, two, three nights, and now all of a sudden they have to discuss, you know, whatever, you know, the purchase of this or the creation of that. I don't think that it would be beneficial for their cause at that point. So,
is there a mechanism, Mr. Camallo, that we can invoke to manage how we would set the expectation for what comes before us for special town meeting?
At this point, there is no such mechanism other than, at least for the departments that report to the town manager, I can have a conversation with the department heads and pass that message.
Okay. Mr. Moderator, any thoughts on that?
No.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, we can't do all. We can't be all things to all people in our lives, in our government, in our business, whatever. You know, ideally, if we could keep this focus to the charter review process, that would be best. So, I guess we have to leave it at that, unless town council's got any other suggestions that we might be able to employ.
I mean, we're only asking other people to wait 3 months until we reach annual town meeting, where they have an opportunity to raise additional items anyway, so I'm not sure what's so critical that can't wait 3 months for the regular process.
Okay.
Do we make those decisions as a board, or?
Technically, no. But
no, there's no provision for any person or body in the town to whittle down whatever the articles are that are on the warrant. From a state legality perspective, we would be able to put something in the charter where we create a group that can go through and kind of, you know, make it more focused. But even in that scenario, that group would never be able to omit any articles that are brought forth by public petition. So,
and that action would have to come through a charter adjustment, right, as well. Okay. So right. The charter review would have to approve the charter review access, right? Yeah. So a couple layers there. Okay, Mr. Kamal.
Mr. Hay, I fully agree with the board's position on this issue, namely managing the special town meeting warrant process, whichever way is possible. However, I also wanted to mention to the public and to the board that there's an issue that did come up at the last Board of Selectmen meeting, namely how the town would protect itself relative to the recently approved recreational marijuana laws. And the idea discussed then was a moratorium. So I just wanted to remind the board that there's that other issue that the board did discuss at its last meeting.
Another very non-controversial issue that we could probably address. Okay, I understand.
What was the official vote in town on that?
4,800 against 4,400.
Okay.
Roughly. Okay. So with that, thank you, Mr. Moderator. Thank you, Pam. With that, the chair will entertain a motion to approve setting, and Mr. Kamal, I'll make sure we get this motion right, approve setting the date of January 30th, 2017 for a special town meeting to consider the Charter Review Committee's findings.
That's fine.
Okay.
So moved.
Seconded. John.
You can second.
John Blue. I'll second that.
So we have a motion on the table and a second by Mr. Catino. Any further discussion on the motion? Pam, is that motion in line with your expectations for the evening?
Very much so. Thank you.
Mr. Moderator, you're good with that?
Yes.
Okay. All those in favor? Aye. Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carries. So we'll see you on January 30th.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Mr. Kamal, if you could get with town council, please, specific to this action tonight, and let him know that the board approved unanimously to set the date for January 30th, and that we need to get the wheels in motion, not only with town council, but with the town clerk and others to make that happen. Okay? Is the town clerk here this evening? There he is. Kamal, would you mind joining us for a sec? Just to wrap this item up, Connor, I think you were here for that discussion. So we've just voted to set January 30th for the special town meeting.
Yep.
I probably should look for you before we voted, but I'm assuming that's okay with you as well.
Yep, I can get the wheels in motion for that.
Okay, great. Excellent. Thank you so much.
You're very welcome.
All right. Item number 5. Is the Lake Maspenok Weed Management and Control Citizen Input Group is going to make a presentation to us this evening. I don't believe that this is an action item for us necessarily this evening, but I do think it's important that we get an update from the group about what's going on with the weeds and how things are progressing at Lake Maspenok. So with that, gentlemen, if you would say hello and introduce yourselves. While some of us may know you well, others may not.
Good evening. My name is Eric Sonnet, and I'm making the presentation for the Weeds Committee tonight.
Okay.
Of course, you gave us a very elaborate name with about 6 or 7.
Yeah, I think I messed it up, too, when I read it. So.
But we refer to ourselves as the Weed Committee.
Okay.
The our committee is made up of various members in the in the town representing various groups. In your charge to us, you said that one of the members should be from Conservation Commission. That is our good friend Jeff Barnes, who's chairman of the Conservation Commission. You said that someone should represent Parks and Rec. I am the representative from Parks and Rec. The chairman of our committee is Jamie Gonzalez. Jamie is a past chairman of the Planning Board. In addition to that, we have Drew Logan, who is a past president of the Lake Maspenok Association. And finally, we have the hardest working member of our committee, Cynthia Estheimer, who knows more about the lake than all of us added together. So the five of us work very closely with two other members. One, John Westerling, our DPW director, who essentially we report to, and Dr. David Mitchell, who is the owner of a consulting company who for the last 30 plus years has dealt with lake management and weed control issues. Dave sits to my left here.
Good evening, gentlemen.
Hi.
And I've learned long ago that when we have a meeting like this and there are questions, always get the guy that knows the answer to sit beside you. And that's the thing that David does. We have concluded our work that you charged us to do. We published the final report. Each of you has received this electronically. And it's very, very detailed with a complete set of references of where the information came from and describes in great detail the analyses and the things that we did over the course of the last year and a half. If we look at the slides, there's our name. Lake Maspenok Aquatic Vegetation Control and Management Advisory Group, the Weed Committee. Give me the next slide, Dave. That's who we are. This slide shows the watershed of the Lake Maspenok. Lake Maspenok watershed is 1,813 acres. The watershed is encompassed in Hopkinton, Upton, and Milford. The lake itself is 234 acres, which grew with dams, etc., from a pond of 40 to 50 acres back at its inception. Maspenok is an Indian term, or an Indian word, meaning water at the foot of the hill. So if you can visualize Maspenok, there's hills going up both sides from the lake. The primary use of the lake is residential, industrial, open space, wetlands, and transportation. Over the years, it was used for many things. Hopkinton got involved with the lake back in 2007 when we purchased the dam from the Milford Water Company, which ensured that the lake would remain a major asset to the town of Hopkinton with subsidiary uses for Upton and Milford. Not much of the lake is in Milford. Upton has a much bigger footprint, but the majority of the lake is in Hopkinton, as are both public accesses to the lake.
Perhaps you could show them with the laser pointer?
I can't. Let me ask a question. If I pointed at that, can you guys see it, or do we have to pull
it? So that's a direct feed from the computer to our friends that are watching at home. So we can't see it. Well,
Dave will point. Do it on the one behind. Which one do the home people get?
Mouse.
Yeah, they're not going to see it at home.
They're not going to see it. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, that's for your references.
It doesn't come show up.
Anyway, the bottom line, there's two public accesses. One is a car top ramp off of Main Street. The other is the town boat ramp adjacent to Sandy Beach.
Okay.
Every other way to access the lake is through private property. The issue and the reason we exist is there are three major nuisance weeds in the lake. The first is the fanwort, very invasive, completely takes over entire areas. The second, and probably the worst, is the variable milfoil, and then the one that's been our biggest problem recently is the large leaf pondweed. These three areas were in overabundance, and they're either native or non-native. The pondweed is native, but the fanwort and the variable milfoil are not. The problem is that it got so congested that it prohibited swimming in major areas. It prohibited boating. It prohibited a general use of the lake. It was completely evasive. And if you've ridden by some lakes in New England and looked at them and seen the large blooms of weeds, you can see that the lakes are very, very useless. One of the good things, even though we have the weeds, is that our water quality is excellent. The water quality is low in nutrients and is not a problem at this point. Now, it was a problem in the 70s and 80s, but the advent of sewers in the area and better control of the stormwater really cleaned the lake up. The lake itself changes its water 1.4 times a year. So with the watershed pulling into the lake, you have new water almost every year and a half, or less than that, more than once a year. The those three things are the reason that we're here. Now, how does one control or go about coming up with a process? Well, what we did was somewhat unique. We corralled every possible way to control weeds in every lake known to man. We got everything. We got insect control. We got animals that swim around and eat weeds. We got virtually everything. Many people wanted to scoop out the lake and get rid of that, you know, those type things. We took all of those things and then looked at them individually on how they would affect and work in Lake Maspenok. What we found was and came up with a series, and I'll show you in a later slide, of the things that would work in Lake Maspenok and how we would use them. We eliminated the bad ones. We highlighted the good ones. We had public input at every one of our meetings, plus we had three public hearings, one or two last February. We did it on a weeknight and we did it on a Saturday, and then we did it again this fall. So we reached out to as many people as we could. In addition, we had a survey of people, an electronic survey. We got 140 responses, and basically it dealt with two issues. One, what do you use the lake for? Primarily, of all the things the lake is used for, swimming was number one, kayaking and canoeing was number two, and fishing was number three. Then there's a whole series of other things, from motorboating to water ski, etc. We also asked the question of how has the lake changed recently? And what is that change? Two-thirds of the people said yes, the lake had changed for the worse, and they identified weeds as the problem. So before we started, a year ago this past summer, we took the opportunity to get in a boat and literally survey the entire lake to see what it looked like when we started and to put a criteria on how big the problem was. Well, I have to tell you, the problem was very serious. We then went to work with the process that I've just identified. And in that process, we ended up with a summary of the vegetation control groups. We have we identified it by management intensity, what it would take to make things happen to control it. We assumed, for example, using the annual drawdown. Now, we did our first survey of the lake before the major drawdown that winter. So we were able to have a before and after what a drawdown would do for us. Basically, it was very, very successful. It doesn't cost anything, and it takes almost no management to make it happen. We are on a cyclical drawdown schedule so that for 2 years in a row, there would be a 5-foot or minor drawdown, and then in the third year, there'd be a major drawdown of 8 feet. We had the major drawdown of 8 feet this past winter, and it was very successful. The only issue is major drawdowns are only successful if the weather cooperates. And that means a hard freeze on top of the exposed areas. It thus kills the weeds. The problem with that is that if it snows, it's warmer under the snow and nothing freezes. So if you have a lot of snow, the drawdown doesn't have near the effect. This past winter, we had very little snow, so it was very successful. The next area we looked at, or the next thing, is a low-intensity kind of thing, and that would be a bathymetric barrier, which is sort of a covering on the bottom of the lake, or hand harvesting. Very inexpensive, $2,000 to $9,000. The next part is a moderate thing. This is if the plants were clearly present, but they had not reached the height where they interfered with any function in the lake. That would be controlled by small-scale harvesting or herbicide treatment or diver-assisted suction harvesting. The cost of that would be $10,000 to $15,000. And then if the lake reverted to what it was when we looked at it a year and a half ago, that would be a high intensity, and it would require large-scale harvesting or large-scale herbicide treatment. Now, that all sounds like trying to bite off more than you can chew at one time. So what we did is we monitor the lake twice this year, once in the spring and once in the fall. When we went out in the spring, we went to the areas that had the highest density from before the major drawdown, and we've broken the lake into 10 management segments. Each management segment is identified separately for the type of weeds within that area and the type of treatment that it would take to control the weeds. You can see that the number one area would be the north shore and middle basin around the shoreline. The second one is the major upper pool. This is the area that you all see when you drive out West Main Street. And it was clearly the most contaminated when we started the area. Then we go into the sandy beach, a shoreline area, and around the boat ramp, and go further south. The area that is least affected by weeds is number 9, which is the major basin of what was the original lake. The lake is on average 8 feet deep, but in that area, it could get as deep as 20 feet through that area. So it's an area where drawdowns don't work, et cetera. So what we did is we matched vegetation control options to the lake management zones. What options were available and cost-effective to treat aquatic weeds in that zone? Several options could be used in many zones. For example, the bathymetric barriers would only be used around Sandy Beach, where we would cover the bottom and stop anything from growing. It takes a lot of labor to do that, because if you leave them down more than one season, then the weeds go over and it becomes part of the bottom and you start all over again. So it has to be laid down like you were laying carpet and then taken up in the fall. very labor-intensive. But the only area that we really work for is around Sandy Beach, where we could get in easily and get it done. The size and cost were also major issues when we looked at it. The good news is we have taken a big lake and turned it into 10 lakes. And each one of those areas would be treated differently at different cost factors and only be treated if that specific area showed that it needed treating. We're not looking at biting the whole apple in this thing and doing a lake. One area might need benthic barriers. Another area might need his little hand harvesting. Another one might need a diver-assisted harvesting. So we have it in a situation where with monitoring, we can literally short-stop any serious blooming of weeds by being on top of it before it happens. Keep in mind that the drawdown this year, when we went out in the spring and looked for weeds, we couldn't find any. We literally could not find any weeds in the lake. We went to the places where the weeds were overwhelming. We drug the bottom. We put measuring things through the tubes, through the muck, and literally did a major area. We identified the 10 areas. We know what weeds grow in those areas. And then we went back in the fall to see what the summer season did to it. And we had no area of the lake where the we only had one area of the lake where the weeds were even at a moderate level. Every other area we classified as low. So we were in a very solid position on having a handle on what the lake looked like and what we do with it. The we then developed controlled options. We took each of our types of ways to control the weeds, and we assigned we put them in an area that they would be most beneficial with our 10 management zones. You can see that the drawdown would be effective in 9 of the 10 zones. The only place not being is the deep pool or the deep southern pool, where the water gets to be 20 feet deep. Hand harvesting works too in areas 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. Benthic barriers, only one area. Diver assistance in two areas. But you can see that basically as we go to each area this spring, we'll have an idea of what's coming and we can plan for it. It literally gives us a way to manage the lake in well-controlled chunks rather than throwing everything at the wall and see what sticks. So we're very bullish about the approach we've taken here. Thresholds for treatment. Now, what would cause us to want to treat? Well, some of the factors we would consider are coverage area of the land area occupied by the plants, the density, how much of the water column is taken up by plants. We literally measured the clarity of the water down to the bottom in most areas. The water is that clear. And we're able to see where the weeds started, and we knew how much fresh water we had above them. So we have a way of measuring and understanding what's going on forward. Topping, what percent of the plants reach the surface of the water, and some areas of where it would be important for the function of the lake, like recreation, like kayaking, etc. So we took all those things into consideration, and we came up with a threshold of when we would take action or recommend taking action in any particular area. We know it needs to be monitored, and we'll talk about more of that in my summary. But the what we have here is stakeholder education. We plan to continue reaching out to the public, especially those who live on the lake, and talk about the things they could be doing and how it would affect the lake. We will inspect and watershed inspection, we would inspect the areas for potential erosion or nutrients getting into the water. So we would be doing water surveys. Would coordinate with town boards like the DPW, like the Conservation Commission, and how to manage and work with them. Many of the things that have to be done, would have to be done in the lake, would require the Conservation Commission to give their approval. We would have a monitoring program for both water quality and aquatic vegetation. And we would have seasonal monitoring for key ingredients, dissolved oxygen, things like that. We would monitor up front to make sure that something wasn't destroying the quality of our water. And then obviously we would be monitoring for aquatic vegetation. We developed a 5-year plan on how to go about this. Year one is 17. As you can see, that the drawdown happens in every year, 2017 through 21, with the next deep drawdown in 2019. Active treatment, what we would, treatments needed, likely to be minor in 17. We don't expect that 17 would require much of anything to happen. At least that's our hope at this point. Based on what we saw a month or so ago, we don't anticipate that it would bloom in the spring. Of course, anything can happen in nature, but we really don't expect that to happen. As you go through the thing, you'll see that the... let me get caught up with myself here. We can see that the identity issues are relevant in watershed inspection. And as you go through, it changes by the year. So we have a way, or what we anticipate at this point. But the good news is the 5-year plan would be a running plan. So as we find things we didn't know about as we go along and come up with effective ways of treating it, we can incorporate that into the plan by adding a year every year. The 5-year plan literally will be something that is a key ingredient to making all of this happen. In summary, and this is the key, I think, and I'm going to read it because I don't want to paraphrase it. Advisory group fulfilled its charge to provide town with comprehensive long-term plan of vegetation management options matched to the Lake Maspenok zones and varying depending on the level of weed infestation. Watershed management and annual monitoring are included. Effective lake management will require creation of a permanent standing committee responsible to the DPW. We kicked that around. The current committee would be willing to continue for at least another year until you come up with how to do this. Basically, we would recommend that the existing committee or those interested, everyone said they were, would be to appoint some of us to 3 years, some to 2 years, somebody to 1 year, so that every year you get a turnover like your other committees, and people who are interested and people who are worn out, the committee would always have fresh blood. The cost will vary from year to year depending on the drawdown schedule and climate variations, etc. What we're recommending is that you continue to fund our committee as you have in the past. In fiscal 2016, you provided us a budget of $60,000. We spent $11,000 and returned $49,000 to the town. This year, we currently have a $60,000 budget, and we have spent $8,000 and would expect by the year's end to return well over $40,000 to the town. The issue we have is when we find a problem in one of our management zones, we can't wait for a town meeting to provide funding to address it, and we can't anticipate up front what that funding would be. What we would ask is that you continue a $60,000 budget, and we'll continue to return it to you as we don't use it. But it would give us the flexibility to react very quickly, sort of like how the DPW reacts to a snowstorm. You don't have to go to the town meeting to get the plows. So from that standpoint, we would appreciate continuation of the budget. And then the five-year cycle lies out action plan for the immediate future and allows for timely adjustment as further information and experience become available. With that, we have enjoyed working together as a committee. I have to tell you, at least from my case, what I didn't know about weeds would fill a volume, and it still will, but I at least know what longleaf pondweed is. I would now enjoy, we have the majority of our committee here tonight. Any questions that you may have between Dr. Mitchell, myself, and Jamie and Sin behind me, I think we'll attempt to answer.
Great. Thank you very much. That was very thorough, very well done. A lot different than when we first started the discussion about weeds at the lake and what we're going to do and how we're going to address it and sort of the panic I think a lot of us felt at the time. So really impressed and really appreciate the input. Mr. Tedstone.
The only question I have is with the deep drawdown, you say every 3 years, why do we hold it to every 3 years? If it's effective, why don't we do it every year?
That's a very insightful question. In fact, it's the one I had. Until we start realizing that with an 1,800-acre watershed, a major drawdown has a real serious effect on the environment of the entire watershed. It affects wildlife. It affects many people have come to our meetings and said, we don't hear the frogs anymore. You all killed the frogs. You know, I mean, it's those type things. And the Corps of Engineers, based on that scenario, is only authorized to do it once every 3 years.
I think the state DEP is also involved in that decision as well.
DEP.
Great. Thank you. Anything else?
That's all I got.
Mr. Catino.
I just think this study is amazing. Point earlier, you know, when we thought about that town meeting, we got very contentious about how to attack this problem. You know, and in this town, people talk about studies. Everybody just rolls their eyes and says, oh, another study, $100,000, $50,000, $200,000. And here is a really good committee was put together, and you broke it up into 10 small lakes. It was just a great way of addressing the problem. And to think that the deep drawdown ends up being one of the best, most effective uses. And, at one point we didn't think that $60,000 was going to even scratch the surface. And to think that both years you gave back $40,000 or so. That's just a great job. It was thorough. I don't have any questions on it at all.
Thank you. Mr. Sestari.
Eric, thanks. That was great. As the other members have said, incredibly thorough, as much or more than we could have expected. So we appreciate that. One of my questions is, first of all, clarification. The last couple of years, obviously, we're appreciative that we had money coming back out of the $60,000, $65,000. No treatment has happened other than the drawdown, though, has it?
No.
Okay, so... once we get into treatment, we can probably expect that number to be, the number being used, at least initially, to be a little higher.
Well, you've seen in the one chart by zone and what the intensity of the weeds are, mm-hmm. It could be $2,000 to $9,000. It could be.
Right.
The only time it would really be an issue is if we had a bloom like we did when we formed this committee. Then we're talking $50,000 to $100,000, and it would requires starting and then going to town meeting or finding a way to come up with the money. We feel that if we monitor it and are on top of it by zone, we can avoid ever having to do that.
Yeah.
And we get to that point, now we're talking about the most $10,000 to $15,000 versus $2,000 to $9,000 or whatever. So we should be able to stay within the budget and hopefully return money every year.
As long as we're making a constant contribution and constant battle, and that everybody realizes that this isn't something you fight once and then walk away for 20 years.
You're right. The minute we blink and don't maintain a standing committee that does what we've done, it will disintegrate rapidly because weeds grow rapidly.
Right. So I guess not a hypothetical, but you know, just if you were to hazard any type of a guess, if this past winter, if we'd gotten our normal snowfall, how much less effective do you think that freeze would have been in the deep drop down?
Well, deep drawdowns are not unique. We had one 3 years ago, mm-hmm. and it did nothing. What we learned this time, and we were very fortunate, with not a lot of snow, but we were able to leave the water out 2 extra weeks, and they happened to be the 2 weeks that were the coldest. If we had filled it up on a normal schedule, it wouldn't have worked.
Perhaps we should show them the slides.
We have we had aerial slides of what the lake.
What allowed us to keep it drawn down for an extra 2 weeks?
A phone call to the Conservation Commission and the DPW, and we were able to not start filling it up again.
Okay.
Typically, the risk of not having water in the lake or not having a wet spring makes people say, oh, we got to start letting that thing fill up. Well, we found out this year that even with a dry spring, it fills right up. Mm-hmm. So I think next year we won't have that problem.
If this can go back, this is the aerial photograph. We had the opportunity, actually John was very wise in getting this in January of this year, and it shows it. You really have to know the lake to know what areas are where it starts. It really, the northern basin was pretty much dewatered. It really was about as good as you could expect to get for a deep drawdown. The combination of...
Right. All the land you see up above is lake. I mean, that was... Mm-hmm. Main Street goes right through it. There was no water in that upper basin at all.
Just one other question. You had mentioned at one point the possibility, I think it was the possibility, not that you have done anything, about monitoring the water that's coming into the lake. And, you know, just to be blunt, you know, the rainwater comes down, people are fertilizing their lawns, fertilizer gets into the lake. Is there anything we can do about that that we haven't already done? Can we ask the Conservation Commission to impose some type of restrictions in a watershed area, anything of that nature, so that we don't have to spend as much money, as much of the town's money, getting rid of weeds rather than preventing them?
The fertilizer is not causing the weeds.
Okay.
It's not making them grow. The things that fertilizers and nitrogen and those things are at a very, very low level in the lake. Just through education of the people that live on the lake or in watershed, advising them to find, you know, the non-nitrous types of fertilizer will have as much effect. What's happening right now is not affecting the water quality of the lake. Having the lake change the water once, you know, 1.4 times a year too, helps significantly. But we have a very healthy lake here. If we just take our good fortune and do what this plan says to do, we will have a major asset.
So your comment, is it that right now in measuring the levels in the water, you're led to believe that people aren't using a lot of nitrogen-based fertilizers, but for the future there should be education to make sure people continue to not use those?
Continue not to. I mean, it's...
I can just recall from one of the meetings, someone got up in front of the public and said, just moved to the area on the shoreline. I know nothing. We're talking about the need to do, you know, landscaping in a way to minimize direct flow, reduction of phosphorus and, you know, nitrogen from the fertilizers or making a buffer zone. And she said, you know, I really like it. It'd be great if I had some information about it. So that's a typical kind of thing that you put a public education pamphlet together, and they're pretty easily put together and then customized for the various. And that's a good thing to give, like almost like they don't do welcome wagon anymore. As people move into areas, be aware not only of just if you've got frontage, but even if you're uphill, what you do uphill still goes down the lake. So I would still say, being a lake scientist, that you'd want to make sure that even though the plants themselves go mostly on the fertilizer, the nutrients within the soil, you still can, you still want, it's a desirable thing to reduce the amount going through. That kind of leads to some of the algal blooms that could occur to it. So,
great. Thank you.
Anything else? No. Mr. Catino.
Yeah, I just have one quick one. With all the studying that was just done, in retrospect, do we have any idea of what caused the big blooms 2 years ago that brought us to this? Because
yeah, lack of paying attention. Got out of hand.
Well, is that so? When you say that, is that something that I guess I'll ask the doctor. You know, if we look at the last 200 years, was this happening 200 years ago on a cyclical basis?
Well, or is there something new? Didn't have a lake as it exists because
okay. Fair enough.
1900s. But it goes back to the 70s. That's the earliest study you had. And they still had the invasive family and the American milfoil there already. So it wasn't something that just came in the last couple of years. The big surprise, I think, that was for this lake was the deep drawdown is pretty effective because those are non-native species and more susceptible to drawdowns. They did a pretty good job of controlling them. What was really the big, you know, nature always surprised you, was the growth of this long, largely pondweed. It's a native. It's generally not a dominant. But it just exploded. It just found, oh, all of a sudden, you know, a combination of no competition, sunlight, and enough nutrients in the sediment. So it just took off. It was kind of unusual. So again, that always shows you that you manage these things as best you can, but you always have to be aware that there's things that take, they're opportunistic. So that was something that came up. But this year, even though, and oh, very quickly, they propagate in a different way than do by more seeds. But this year, the drawdown really knocked out everything. It really was very
cold.
Good. I mean, it was, just from day and night what we saw in August, or pardon me, in June of 2015, this last year. And as we said, so we're going to go out there in May and look and see what the growth is, because they start to grow fairly early in the season and see if there's issues or potential concerns.
Even if the drawdown works, let me just make one final point. Even if the drawdown works, drawdowns kill roots of plants. The long leaf pondweed grows by seeds. It's an annual. So what happens is it drops its seeds in the fall. They get down into the soil, and then regardless of what the drawdown does, then they start up again because they're coming from seeds and not from existing plants. So we have to be very vigilant about the long. That's what happened that made the whole thing explode in the first place. A drawdown had killed a lot of the invasive stuff, and pondweed took over.
So the chair will table this discussion for one moment, please, to open a public hearing. The chair will entertain a motion to open a posted public hearing for an amended license to the Blue Hills Fuels, located at 60 Main Street in Hopkinton, Massachusetts.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion on the motion? All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
The posted public hearing for the Blue Hills Fuels discussion is open. The chair will continue that discussion for a few minutes. We're going to be doing a series of these, folks, over the next hour, so just kind of hang in there with me on this. Jerry, we'll be with you in a couple minutes here. Okay, so the elephant in the room, herbicides. When do herbicides get used? Who makes the decision to use herbicides? I saw them in the plan. I don't think we've used any to date. That was the big thing that everybody was concerned about a year or so back. But this presentation doesn't necessarily mean the authority and the responsibility rests with the committee for herbicide introduction, correct?
Well, how you set up the committee will determine that. We're just an advisory committee right now. What we're recommending is a standing committee that you give authority to address it by zone. The herbicide issue is identified in two or three of the zones as the most effective, cost-effective way of doing it. Its alternative to that can be very, very expensive. So if you want to set guidelines on how to approach that, or if you want that standing committee to come back to you at that point when they've identified a problem, you can set the committee up to do that.
I think what you presented tonight is awesome. I think breaking it down into the 10 zones and all the different things that you talked about before herbicides get introduced is excellent. I can't see a whole lot of pushback on why we wouldn't look at those measures and take action on those measures. I think the question of herbicides, though, remains outstanding, and how and when and if they are implemented remains outstanding. And I think it's beyond what we can get into tonight, but something that has to still be sort of formalized, to your point, either through your committee or another committee at some point in the near future. Do you agree with that, Mr. Kamal?
Yes.
Mr. Chair.
Mr. Starr.
Just one more question for the doctor through you. On the topic of herbicides versus non-herbicides, have you worked with communities or bodies of water that insisted on no herbicides? And if so, what's been your experience?
I've worked on lakes where they were not, for whatever reasons, were not preferred. I mean, mm-hmm. I say that. I think the committee was smart in allowing this as a possibility. In just general, why? It's a matter of effectiveness and cost. I mean, there's definitely non-chemical ways to treat this. We've suggested that hand harvesting such. If you're dealing with a relatively large, by large, you know, 5 to 20 acres, then you're probably looking at something like harvesting as a way of reducing them down, getting them down from the surface and all that. It's essentially like mowing the lawn. Chemicals are another way of treating them. They're also a short-time fix. They don't, you know, have any lasting value. So there are times when, because of perhaps access problems to harvesters or the location you're in, really is either no treatment or the possibility of herbicides. So I think, again, you try to be flexible. You try to think about what uses are being there. See alternatives first. I think what we're going to try to do, or what I should say the committee will try to do, is over the first couple of years, see what works in the various kinds of methods. Makes evaluations on that. The idea that this is going to be a management plan that, like your chart, gets reviewed on a regular basis and say, what's worked, what's been not worth the effort, and try to work from there. But it's very hard to come, you know, it's like telling the surgeon, you can use two ways of treating cancer, but you can't use a third. Mm-hmm. So there's ways of doing it, but it doesn't necessarily give you as wide a spectrum of alternative options.
Great, thank you.
Okay, so again, great job. Thank you very much. The herbicide piece of the puzzle remains outstanding. There's no authority to treat the lake with herbicides at this time. The committee can't grant that authority to anybody. The DPW director is nodding his head in agreement. Mr. Kamala, you are in agreement as well, right? That's a separate topic that we still have to look at. But other than that, I think watching it, maintaining it, and doing all the other things that you've talked about make an awful lot of sense to me, not knowing weeds like Mr. Sonnet now knows weeds, and obviously like the doctor knows the problem. So we're up against it with the clock. There are people in the audience tonight that feel very strongly about this. I'm going to take a little risk, roll the dice here, without getting into a debate about herbicides, because it's not authorized. Does anybody in the audience have anything they would like to share that hasn't already been discussed? Yes, sir. If you could just come to the microphone real quick.
Don Kaiser, I live on Oakhurst Road.
Hi, Don.
I just want to thank you, Brian, for pulling out the elephant in the room here. And I think that we need to really look at that down the road.
Yeah, I understand. Fair enough. Anybody else? Okay, with that, we'll table it. We'll accept the report, obviously. Table this discussion about herbicides. We do need to come back to this at some point in the near future. But I think the committee's done an awesome job. We would ask you to continue. I think that's, we're not disbanding this committee. There's no decisions being made tonight, right? And continue the good work of monitoring and keep us posted, and we'll get back to you on the budget as we get into budget season in more detail. Right?
Yes.
Anything else?
Just a formal vote by the board accepting the report would be
probably. Okay. Chair will entertain a motion to accept the report as supported or as submitted by the Lake Maspenok Weed Management and Control Citizen Group.
Absolutely.
No, you didn't say the whole thing.
I know. I got close. There's a motion by Mr. Gattino.
Second.
And a second by Mr. Sestari. All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carries. Thank you very much. Okay, folks, we have a public hearing that we opened and continued for a few minutes. We also have the Boston Marathon Invitational number distribution process that we need to go through. We have several public hearings kind of lined up. It looks like it's kind of like looking at a runway full of planes here today with these public hearings lined up. So I'm going to ask a simple question on the Marathon Invitational number distribution process. Is it the board's feeling that we can move through that very quickly based on the information you've been provided to date, or does the board feel that this could take a while?
I think we can probably move through it quickly.
Think we can move through it quickly? Everybody okay with that? So with that agreement that we're going to move through it quickly, let's try and get that done so we can get back on track here. Okay, Mr. Kamalo, could you introduce us very quickly to the topic specific to the Boston Marathon number distribution process?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. First off, I want to take this opportunity to thank Maria Glynn for the work that she did in getting us to this point. Secondly, also confirm to the public that so far from my review of the process, the board has complied with the town's marathon policy. Thirdly, every year the board reviews the invitational entry requests. There are new and exciting opportunities that come to the fore. Two issues need to be mentioned in this year's process. Obviously, the interest was greater to the point that the board did receive an application that came in after the deadline. The board has a clear policy in that regard. There's a deadline that is specified, and everybody is requested to comply with that deadline. And then secondly, there was also an interest in the qualifying applications pool from groups that normally have not applied for this opportunity in the past years. Namely, we have the high school class of 18 and 19 requesting invitational entries. I had a very detailed discussion with the advisor to the class of 2018. My interest was in two areas. One, better understanding who they are, and then two, how they characterize the work that they do, the activities that they perform that benefit the greater community. And here's what I learned. I learned that this is a practice that has been in place for many years in the community. The charge given to each class is to identify an opportunity to create a legacy that benefits the school and also gives back to the school community. By way of illustration, here's what they have accomplished in past years. Number one, they have done photo murals, and one of them is in the athletic center. Two, they did provide a bronze statue that is in the hands of the schools. And thirdly, in terms of this year, what I heard from Mr. Longoria, who is the advisor to the class of 2018, is that they are approaching this from the viewpoint of challenging the high school students to contribute to the community. They are very open-minded in terms of how they can apply the funding that they may secure through this process. They are even willing to accept, if the board is inclined to accept their application, accept a condition that earmarks the use of the funds. They are willing to work with groups in town that focus on hunger and other issues, for example. So I felt it was important for me to highlight this new opportunity that has come up through this process.
So is it your recommendation that those two groups be included in the applications that have been received and under consideration?
Yes.
Okay.
In terms of the actual application, I included a memo for the board that identified who applied. I brought the group, the applications into two groups. There's a group including the town departments. Nothing has changed from last year. They are still requesting the same number of entries as before, namely 29. We also received applications from 18 civic organizations in town qualifying for the remaining 21 entries. My recommendation is twofold. The board could look into two options. First option is to distribute the invitational entries equally to all the 18 groups that applied, and then hold a lottery for the remaining numbers. Secondly, I created a group that identifies qualifying civic organizations that are also receiving entries from town departments. The board may back those out from the group, and then first round, give the invitational entries one each to the remaining numbers of the remaining number of civic organizations, and then phase two, bring those organizations back into the pool and conduct a random selection. So those are the options I offer to the board.
Can you read the 18 applicants that we've received on time prior to tonight's meeting?
Should we hold our questions to the end, or as there's a question on an applicant, should we raise it immediately?
I would raise it immediately.
Okay.
Just so we can keep this moving as quickly as possible. Mr. Kamal. And I'm going to have to open another public hearing here in about 3 minutes. So when I interrupt you, please don't be offended.
Okay, great. These are the entities that applied. The Hopkinton Public Library Fans.
Question?
Yep.
I see down on the bottom for the departmental requests that there's Friends of Hopkinton Public Library. Already getting two waivers through that facility. Is it the same group?
It's the same group, yes.
Okay.
In fact, my understanding is that the library department offers one entry to the Friends and one entry to the foundation. The foundation is the next group that applied, the Hopkinton Public Library Foundation.
Let me just jump in on that, but to your question, that's what's been used in the past as well, is that avenue for those numbers?
I'm not sure I understand.
What you're seeing there, the town, the 29 on the town department side,
yeah,
have been doled out in the past, similar to what you're seeing here.
Right. All I'm saying is that these two groups already have one before we
see the lotteries. There's going to be several.
Okay.
Mr. Kamal.
There's also the Hopkinton Education Foundation, the Sampa 5 Fund. This is a new application, I believe. The Hopkinton Women's Club, Baypath Humane Society of Hopkinton, Project Just Because, and then the two high school classes, one for 2018 and the other for 2019, Michael Lisno Respite Center, the Keep Smiling for Abby Foundation, the Hopkinton Music Association, Leave for Ivan, Inc., the Hopkinton Parents Teacher Association, the Friends of Hopkinton, SPIAC, Hopkinton Tax Relief Fund Committee, Hopkinton Center for the Arts, and Enter Stage Left Theater.
Question?
Yes. Mr. Kripps, sorry.
The Hopkinton Center for the Arts and Enter Stage Left. Are they under this? What type of organization is it? You know, structurally from a legal standpoint,
Mr.
501(c)(3) or something like that. And I'm just wondering if they're under the same structure as each other.
Mr. Kamal, hold for 1 minute, please. The chair will entertain a motion to open the public hearing. For the specific purpose of amending the application for an alteration of premise or change of location, as submitted by Mr. Jeffrey Barton, manager of Waterfresh Farm, LLC, 151 Hayden Row in Hopkinton, Mass.
So moved.
Second.
So we have a motion and a second on the table to open the public hearing. Any discussion? All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? The chair will continue that public hearing to a future time, hopefully soon. Mr. Kamal.
Yeah, they each exist as independent private non-profit organizations. However, they also have the relationship under the Hopkins Center for the Arts, HCA.
Okay, so they have their own separate budgets, they're funded separately, etc. Okay, thank you.
Okay, so we have 18 applications that have been submitted to the board. You all have a email chain, I believe it is, copy in front of you from the Hopkinton Country Club Charitable Foundation. I don't know the full details of what did not happen with the submission prior to one that came in after the fact. And this is a comment that Mr. Kamala was alluding to earlier. I think the first question before the board is, are we going to stay with the 18 applications that we've received, or is there an inclination to consider the situation with the Hopkinton Country Club Charitable Foundation and its submission of an application?
Do we have ample amount of numbers to give if we accept these people?
We have 21 numbers sort of in this pool that we're looking at now to distribute outside the 29 that the town departments have typically received in years past that we've overseen, but understand what's going on there. So we do have 21 numbers. Mr. Connell made a point earlier that, you know, it was not, to the best of our knowledge, was not received on time. Is that correct?
Yeah, that is correct. And in addition, there are also other entities in town that called in after the deadline, and we gave them the response that their applications would not qualify.
Okay. So does anyone want to weigh in on this particular request first?
I think we need to stick with the rules.
Okay.
Make it much easier to just stick with the process as we move forward.
Okay. Does anybody have any strong opinion otherwise? Okay, so with that, we have 18 applications that were received in Town Hall on time and within the guidelines as set forth in terms of priority, et cetera. So let me just describe, you know, in years past what we have done after we established this policy to manage these numbers. And the reason we do this and oversee it, if you take 50 numbers times $5,000, it's $250,000, quote, market value, that these numbers can be used to raise funds for. It's a lot of money, and they come to the community, and the community should sort of be aware of what's going on. That's what started this several years ago. So with what we've done in the past, to be fair and equitable, and correct me, those of the sat here before on this issue, we have typically issued one number to each of the applications that came through that we deemed appropriate. And I don't think, other than the discussion about the two applications for the school classes, there's much question that any of the others are not appropriate. Hopkinton-focused, Hopkinton-oriented, Hopkinton-driven charitable organizations. And then that would leave us with three additional numbers that we could then decide what to do with.
Yeah, I guess I'd like to just make a comment on the two high school classes. When I first heard that these groups were applying for these numbers, my initial reaction was, I'm not sure if that's really fitting in with the spirit of what we intended here. And prior to Mr. Kamalo's comments, seeing the gentleman come up and state their case, you know, I started realizing, you know, first of all, some of this is geared toward creating some of the activities for our successful students in our classes, keeping them active. What can be better for the community than that, right? And so, you know, I'm certainly inclined to go along with that. One thing that I would like to say is that I understand Mr. Kamala was talking about, I guess, bringing on a tradition that has been in the past, at least sporadically, and you know, bringing that back to life and possibly expanding that so that these classes have more impact throughout the community. I'd love to see that happen. I think that with that in mind, you know, this tends to be quite a bit of money. You know, we've been looking at the last couple of years where runners are raising $4,500 and $5,000 and up. And I guess I would hesitate to give a single class more than one entry over the 4 years that they're trying to do this, unless these young gentlemen and their classes and the others behind them prove that this money really is contributing more directly to the community as well. So I'm all on board in trying this. These guys, you know, I mean, I think they got their stuff together. You know, I have no question that they're going to be doing their best and giving it back to the community as well. But that needs to be a continued tradition in my mind. So
I think you raise an excellent point, and I'm sure past applicants and participants understand this, and perhaps new ones haven't heard it yet. But the board requests an accounting after the fact, after the marathon is over. The runner will hopefully and definitely finish, step on that finish line, and then you'll compile a report of what was raised and what the funds were used for, et cetera, so that the board can sort of track to make sure that everything is within our expectations. So I think you get that at that time. It's a great, great reminder.
Now, you guys will have to have a parent run, right? So they'll be kind of working for it. Huh? Great.
Somebody 18 and over, so.
Right.
Okay, so then the first step in this process, in my mind, is we have 18 applicants for 21 numbers available to us at this juncture. Is everybody okay with the concept of one applicant to each of the eight, or one number, one bid to each of the 18 applicants?
Well, what about the other one that Norman Kamala was talking about, that we break out 13? Because some of these groups have no other method of getting a number. You know, we've got some in here that are getting numbers from other organizations within out of 29. We've got the respite center that gets another 30 from other organizations also. And they are going to get theirs from the Kalalas. They will be made whole this year. So I just want to make sure that everyone has a fair shot, just like these kids that came up.
Well, I think if we do go ahead and issue one to each of the 18, they'll all get one minimum. The question and the concern, I think, raised that there's numbers coming from other town entities to some of these organizations is a good one. It's been a past practice that's happened then as well. There's a lot of really well-established charitable organizations on this list that do very well raising funds, but then do very well distributing those funds. And if
but through the chair, we also have to make sure that all of these entities understand that how difficult it is for the town to secure these entries every single year, and to base all of their fundraising on just this may not be a safe platform.
Absolutely.
The BAA they get tougher and tougher to get every single year, and we had to fight for every single one of these entries this year.
Yep.
And it may be even tougher in years to come. So that's just my little caution.
No, so you've done a lot to make this happen, so I certainly understand where you're coming from. Mr. Sestari.
I'm just wondering, are we looking at procedurally how we want to go about this right now? I think it's pretty clear that at least the first 18, you know, we could probably take a vote and vote that all 18 get a number.
I think that's the first step we're trying to get to.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mr. Chair, I'd like to move that the 18 applicants are each awarded one number from the charity numbers given by the BAA and granted to the town.
Second.
Okay, so we have a motion on the table. Second. Any further discussion?
Just that the motion reflects that it's one invitational entry.
One invitational entry per application received on time.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Okay. Any further discussion? Mr. Kamala, are you okay with the motion?
Yes.
Since you just modified it?
Yeah.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, so that leaves us with three invitational numbers In addition to those we just assigned, here it gets a little bit more subjective, I think, than our first step in this process. In years past, we have looked at the categories of the qualifications and the criteria of the different organizations. Good night, gentlemen. Thank you.
Good luck.
And then assigned a couple of numbers in that, using that criteria, the criteria really focusing primarily on Hopkinton-based organizations with Hopkinton-based individuals, you know, driving results with strong ties to the community, et cetera. So
I'm just going to throw out, you know, and this it doesn't have anything against any of the organizations here, you know, although I do try to whittle it down a little bit, looking at the organizations that are getting numbers from other sources as well. But I'll just suggest giving an additional number each to Project Just Because, Keep Smiling for Abby, and Live for Evan.
So, I'm sorry, Project Just Because.
Keep Smiling for Abby.
Yeah.
And Live for Evan.
Live for Evan. Okay. Does anyone else have any other thoughts that they want to put on the table as far as these three go?
They're all fabulous organizations, and that's, you know, that's, you know, we had the Simplify Fund in with us 2 weeks ago, two meetings ago, when they did the crowns, and you know, they raised $80,000 in there for their last run. There's you know, there's, you know, Bay Path, it's just a wonderful, the women's club, they, you know, it just, you know, I, part of me, you know, wants to just draw them out of a hat, but who could say no to Sister Starry's three choices?
Okay. Mr. Tedstone, any thoughts?
Project Just Because, is that a, I understand what that charity is somewhat, but does that base a majority of its charitable donations to people in Hopkinton specifically?
I don't have the percentages, but having been over there a few times and dropped things off and done some other stuff, I would think so, yes.
That's my understanding.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. As long as that is keeping people.
Yeah. I think people in the region can stop in and yeah, help get, you know, what they're looking for perhaps, yeah, as well. But I know that it always opens my eyes when I go to that organization and others in town and see the needs that exist in our own community.
Yep.
You know, we see it on TV and we read it in the newspaper and we see it online, the challenges in our world today. But we have challenges at home too, and Project Just Because is one of those organizations that I think does amazing work, and if we can support them, I think it would be great.
Okay. Good.
And to Mr. Sestari's suggestion, you know, the other two organizations, and I think there was an accent, pretty strong accent there for it, Live for Evan. Live for Evan is a very strong organization here in Hopkinton, coming out of a situation from several years ago with a young man, and certainly keep Abby Smiling, another organization coming out of a situation from a couple years ago where there's very strong ties in the community to support the legacy of these kids and their families going forward. So
that was a very powerful presentation that her father did a couple of weeks ago.
Yeah, yeah.
So I'm in line with Mr. Sestari's suggestions.
So with that, I'll second it.
So we have a motion on the table and a second to award 1, 2, 3 additional to Project Just Because, Keep Smiling for Abby, and the Live for Evan Foundation. I apologize if I'm getting the name wrong, but Live for Evan. Okay, so with that, and we have some folks in the audience here representing certain organizations, we're trying to do this as fair and equitable and as Hopkinton-centric as we can, but certainly if somebody has some thoughts that they want to share before we engage in our vote on this issue, please raise your hand. Everybody okay? All right, so with that, all those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? So it's unanimous and so carries. So, Mr. Kamal, if you could direct the 18 to the applicants, as well as those three to the applicants for that second number, we would appreciate it very much, with the understanding that obviously the report out following the marathon next year is part of the process. Okay. With that, the chair is going to open a public hearing scheduled for 8:30 p.m. This is actually, I don't have to do that because that's a continued public hearing. Never mind. Okay. So we're going to go to item number 7 on the agenda now very quickly. This is a public hearing that we opened a few minutes ago. We will continue it now. This is to amend a license for Blue Hills Fuels located at 60 Main Street in Hopkinton. Mr. Kamal, can you introduce the issue before the board, please?
Yes. This is an issue that is coming before the board through the work of various town departments. I want to thank the town clerk's department for its work with, again, Maria Glenn going through the laws supported by Elaine Lazarus as well as town council. With regard to this specific application, it's coming to the board after a complete review by the fire department. In my last conversations with the permitting team, there are no objections that they've raised regarding the application.
And what is it specifically requesting?
It's the... If you give me one second. I'll give you the exact amount of gallonage that they're requesting. Do you have the document up here, by the way?
1,000 above ground? 1,000 above ground?
That's the propane,
yeah,
I think,
gallons. Yeah. the maximum quantity of LP gas to be stored in the above contains 1,000 gallon AST. And the amount that we're reviewing in total, I believe, Fire Chief, correct me if I'm wrong, this is above 10,000?
Above 10,000.
Yes, it's above 10,000.
Okay, thank you. So we're in a public hearing specific to this question. Does the applicant have anything that he would like to share with the board?
It's just used for heating oil.
Okay. Does any of the members of the board have any questions for the applicant or the town manager?
So we got what you have for your business.
Jerry, would you mind joining us at the guest table here?
I'm just going to restate what I believe you just said. You've got what you had for your business, and now you put in one of these waste oil heaters, and you need storage for that. And before you were already at your limit to your license, so now you need to amend it. Okay. And I'm looking at this, the total is 36,000 gallons of all the flammable liquids to be stored. Is that accurate?
Well, the gasoline is bottles.
Yeah. And then there's two 250s for the waste oil,
right,
and another 60 for gasoline.
60, that's what's in the cars. If we left cars inside, they take that into account.
Okay.
And then we have some drums.
Oh, got it. All right. I don't have any other questions, Mr. Chair.
Anyone else have any questions for the applicant or Mr. Kamal?
So you're just looking for another 250 gallons to store used oil for your waste oil heater, correct?
I think that's what the increase
is.
Yeah. That's very efficient, I think.
Yeah, so to go from...
You all set?
30, yeah. Go ahead.
Set?
Yeah, I'm set.
Okay, so if everybody's good with the applicant and the presentation by Mr. Kamalo, we'll then go to abutters. Are there any abutters here this evening that have any comments or questions, concerns? Seeing none, we'll then open it to the public. It is a public hearing. The public has a right to be heard. Anyone here this evening to comment on this particular issue before the board? Seeing none, the chair will entertain a motion to close the public hearing specific to the Blue Hills Fuels and 60 Main Street.
Second.
Motion and second to close the public hearing. Any discussion on the motion? All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Okay, now the board will deliberate the request in front of it.
I would like to make a motion to accept the
approve
as requested.
Excellent.
And I'll second that.
So we have a motion on the table to approve the increase in the storage tank as requested, with a second by Mr. Catino. Mr. Kamal, with a motion.
Yes, and it's in reference to the flammable and combustible liquids, gases, and solids.
That's in the motion?
Yes.
Absolutely.
And that's in the second. Okay. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carries. You're all set, Jerry. Thank you for coming tonight. Thank you for your patience. Okay. We're going to move on now to item number 8 on our agenda. We opened a public hearing at 8:15 and continued it. The chair will now entertain continuing it at this time. This is for an amendment to the application, or an amendment application for an alteration of premise or change of location at 151 Hayden Row in Hopkinton, Massachusetts, submitted by Mr. Jeffrey Barton, manager of Water Fresh Farms, LLC. Jeff, if you wouldn't mind joining us at the guest table with those that are going to represent you or participate. Perhaps, Phil, if you could just jump in behind there, that'd be great. Thank you. Mr. Nealon.
Chairman.
How are you?
I'm doing well, and you?
I'm well, thank you. How can we help you?
So, we are here to amend the license for Water Fresh, Chapter 138, Section 15, retail alcohol license, simply reducing the area in the marketplace for which they would use to sell their product.
Okay.
That's it.
Mr. Kamal.
Yes, and in fact, for the sake of the public, this is a package store license. The request to alter the floor area is in response to the recently established brewery in the same location.
That we're going to come to in our continued public hearing here in a few minutes, assuming we wrap this one up shortly.
We have circulated the application to the town's permitting departments, reviewed multiple iterations of the submission with town council, and at this point, Tom, through the chair, feel free to jump in. I believe all issues have been addressed.
All issues have been addressed.
Okay. I checked with town council specific to this coming for us tonight. And his response to me was that while there might be a couple of very minor little clerical things or things of that nature, he was confident that this application, this amendment, was in line and ready to move forward. Is that a fair statement, Mr. Kamal?
Yes, that is correct. Specifically for the public's information, I think the major issue was, in fact, twofold, specifying the floor area, the total floor area for the package store license, and secondly, consulting with the fire department, the building inspector, to confirm the occupancy limit for that area.
Okay. Any questions from the board?
Is this alteration strictly related to the sale of liquor? I guess, is the desire to make this alteration tied in any way to the approval of the brewery pouring license?
No, I don't think. I think this is our spot trying to just split off.
I just wanted to see if there should be some contingencies. I didn't want you to get bound into something with the possibility of the pouring license, you know, not passing or passing or whatever, and then all of a sudden say, well, if I had known that, I wouldn't have done that. Okay, great. Thank you.
Set?
I am.
Mr. Tedstone. All good? Mr. Catino.
I'm good.
Okay. All right, so we are within a public hearing, and the board has kind of done its first round. Are there any abutters here this evening to 151 Hayden Rose Street that would like to ask questions, express concerns, anything of that nature? Okay, seeing none. Are there any members of the general public here, residents of Hopkinton, interested or concerned or have any questions specific to the issue before us for 151 Hayden Rose Street? Okay, Mr. Kamal, see any reason why we can't close the public hearing?
I do not identify any reason why the board cannot close the public hearing at this point.
So with that, the chair will entertain a motion to close the public hearing specific to the amendment of the applications.
So moved. Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion on the motion? All those in favor? Aye.
Aye. Aye.
So the public hearing is closed through a unanimous vote, and now the board will deliberate the request in front of it to amend the application. Mr. Catino, any thoughts?
No, it's really straightforward and reducing, not adding. So it's not, the next one might get a little bit more complicated, but this one seems pretty straightforward.
Tipping your hat, Mr. Sestari, any thoughts?
I have no other questions.
Okay, Mr. Tedstone.
Nope.
Mr. Kamal, do you have a recommendation for the board specific to this request?
Recommend that the board consider approving the request to alter the premises for the package store license as identified tonight.
Okay. Mr. Nealon, any further thoughts, comments?
I think we're fine, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Okay. Chair will entertain a motion to approve the amended application for an alteration of premise or change of location specific to 151 Hayden Row, Hopkinton, Mass., as presented this evening.
So moved.
Second.
You good with the motion, Mr. Kamal?
Yes.
Any discussion on the motion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carries. Okay, so all set on that particular piece of the puzzle.
Thanks,
thank you, gentlemen. Next up, we're going to continue the public hearing that began a couple weeks back, specific to Startline Brewing Company. There's an application for a farmer brewer pouring permit license under Mass General Law Chapter 138, Section 19CN, submitted by Edwin Twinney of Craft Life Brewing Company, otherwise known as Ted, doing business as Startline Brewing at 151 Hayden Row Street in Hopkinton. So we're now back in our public hearing specific to this request and this application. Do where we are? Mr. Neal.
Mr. Chairman. You folks remember Mr. Twinney from a few months back. So we're back here before you. There have been some changes made to a few things that were brought up by Town Council prior to the hearing back in late September, or early October, I'm sorry. And we'll just address those for you. I think the biggest ones were the seating areas, the outside seating, that has now been reduced to the tavern room and the immediate seating area right outside the brewery, and it's shown on the plan. That's part of your package. The other issue which you folks just addressed was the area of use is not in conflict with the area of use by Waterfresh Market. The third concern was whether or not there were rights in Startline Brewery's lease to operate a pouring license. That lease has been amended to allow on-premise serving of alcohol. And I think lastly was the
Mr. Nealon, while you're looking through notes, if I could interrupt 1 minute, please. The chair will entertain a motion to open a public hearing specific to the alcohol policy changes under consideration by the Board of Selectmen.
So moved.
Second.
So we have a motion on the table and a second to open the public hearing scheduled for 8:45 p.m. Any discussion on the motion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. So that public hearing is now open. The chair will continue that discussion to a future time. Mr. Nealon.
And I'll just reiterate, in terms of the area of use at the marketplace, I think there were proposed five areas, a function room that has been taken out, the outside seating has been taken out, the greenhouse has been taken out. So it's really been brought down to the areas either immediately inside the brewery or directly adjacent to the brewery.
Okay. Anything else?
That's it.
Mr. Kamalo, any input on the question or the issue?
I believe I concur with Mr. Nealon's position that all the outstanding issues have been addressed to our satisfaction.
I, too, checked with town council on this specific issue and where we stood based on some of the other things that have progressed here in recent weeks. And there as well, he said, you know, other than maybe a couple of typos here and there, some minor tweaks that we'd have to deal with, probably with the ABCC looking at it anyway, that everything seemed to be in order and ready to move forward. Mr. Tedstone.
Well, as long as it passes Mr. Mayari's, the fire chief and the police chief, and Mr. Kamalu's smell test, then I'm good with it.
Okay. Mr. Catino.
I'm just, my only concerns are is the morphing that's taken place in this area that originally was a farm, and it's in the middle of a neighborhood, and this is, I know this would normally be Claire's end of the world right here, and she's probably watching saying thank you, John, for saying it, because, you know, it started off as a farm, a farm stand, and then grew and grew and grew, and I just want to make sure that the abutters are being heard from. Because, you know, now we're talking light manufacturing when we're really talking about doing beer. So it went from a farm stand to a store to an ice cream stand, and now and then selling beer and wine, and now some light manufacturing going on. And so I just want to make sure that the abutters are all in line with this, because, you know, we're taking a farm and turning it into a production site. And as long as the abutters are okay with it, then I'll be all set. But you know, they have to have a voice in this.
Yep, we're in the midst of a public hearing, so to your point, we'll come back to the abutters here very shortly. Anything else? Mr. Starry.
Yeah, I do have problems with this. I guess my first question is to Mr. Kamalo. I had requested some information from town council regarding our ability to limit the amount that's poured to any individual. What was the result of that query?
Yes, I did review the question with town council, specifically whether the board has the ability to limit the volume of alcohol that can be poured for an individual customer, either in terms of the amount itself or in terms of the number of glasses that can be offered to an individual customer. Town Council responded that the board does not have the ability to do so. The ABCC has specific regulations that they specify in terms of how much beer could be supplied to an individual customer. And so the board does not have the authority to further limit those restrictions.
So I have a tough time with this then. For many of the same reasons that Mr. Catino stated, you know, I think that when the zoning was changing for this area initially and the plans were being laid out, I remember talking with several members of the planning board and other committees that were involved as well. And you know, again, the story was this is going to be a beautiful farm stand. This is going to be amazing. And it is. And we've seen that morph. The products being delivered there are outstanding. And this is a difficult decision for me because I'm a home brewer myself, and I carry that dream of, you know, someday, you know, maybe getting bigger and letting other people taste my wares as well. And I'd love to see this work, but for me, one of the models I've seen at other breweries, and I'm thinking of a couple of them in particular in Vermont, is that, you know, you go in, you know, you can, you know, they have their tasting room, you get your number so that you can get your growler. While you're waiting, you go up, you can buy yourself a beer, you can buy yourself two beers, but that's it. Then you buy your growlers and you leave. It's great for getting a taste of the beers. The flights are a great idea. You know, it's more of a volume thing. It's not an actual number of glasses kind of thing. And then everybody continues to move on. And what I see here and what I fear is this morphing now. We started with the farm stand and grocery store with some sandwiches, beer, and now we're moving into, you know, what's a bar. And it's not a full alcohol bar, but it is a bar nonetheless. And that's where I have an issue. And, you know, to me, it's not so much, you know, whether the direct abutters mind or not, but it's more along the lines of, you know, what was the intent when we started down this road and permits were approved. And it's, you know, from my conversations when it was happening, I don't think that this was envisioned. And, you know, then there are other things regarding sharing the same building, there being connections between the two areas and things of that nature as well. But those are more minor, in my opinion. But at this point, I don't think I can support it as it stands.
Okay. Mr. Catino, another question?
And my worry is that I just hope it's not in your business plan to become like a Jack's Abbey, and you go there in Framingham, and the overflow parking is going into the Phillips parking lot where I used to work, and because that would really change the whole feel of the neighborhood. It would change the feel of the road in front and everything else. You know, as great as that would be for I'm very pro-business, and I appreciate the business growing, but again, it's the location of such growth, and that's my fear, is that it could morph into something that size.
Okay. So we're going to deliberate the question after we close the public hearing portion of this discussion or of this issue. So I'm going to kind of hold off on the sort of the deliberation for a couple minutes here, if that's all right. Any other questions specific to the applicant from the board at this time?
What are the allowances within the law without this specific license? What are the allowances for the brewery to pour samples before someone decides on a growler? Are there any? Can they serve any type of a little sampler? Or?
Yeah, that's my... Good evening, everyone. Thanks for your time. It's my understanding that we are being compliant with a 2-ounce pour policy per individual, 8 samples max, which we don't. We only offer one of each of our beers, and we have 5 beers. So it's, you know, we have a small counter. If you come into the marketplace, you'll see we have a very small counter. It's basically allowing 2 to 3 people standing there having a sample. So anybody else who wants to, it's all counter service. We never plan in current state or future state to have table service.
Right.
So you got to come up to the counter. We have to interact with you and perform our compliance with tips. We'll offer you a sample of our beer. And if you'd like to take beer to go, that is our current operation today.
And I'll be honest, you know, the way you describe it, it's something where I think to myself, you know, okay, they got a small counter. What's the harm in this? You know, I mean, there's not the room there right now to make this, you know, a bar.
Right.
But then at the same time, I have to remind myself that this property has morphed so much already that it's entirely possible that 5 years from now, you are so successful that, you know, you start expand. Maybe 2 years from now, you're so successful, you expand, you know, you work with the owners and you expand your space, and now you're using half the space instead of, you know, a quarter of the space or whatever. And now all of a sudden you have a 15-foot bar, and you do have tables. You're asking us for an expansion, and then we're saying, boy, you know, do we try to keep this guy down by saying no to an expansion, or, you know, do we, you know, say, hey, here's a successful business, and we want him to be more successful? Like I say, this is, for me, it's not an easy discussion. It's not an easy decision. But those are my observations and my concerns.
Okay, so with that, why don't we see if we have any abutters here this evening that have any thoughts, questions, concerns specific to the application. Are there any abutters to 151 Hayden Row? It's 151, right? Yeah. Seeing none, are there any members of the general public, Hopkinton residents, interested in offering an opinion or asking any questions specific to the application? Seeing none, anybody from the general public? Okay, Mr. Kamala, any reason why you don't think we should not close the public? Yes, sir. Jeff.
Yeah, Brian. So I just wanted to make a comment, because I heard a lot of this is like business morphing. So when we opened the doors in January of 2012, everything that was there, everything that's there now was there then. We just had it in more space. The ice cream was opened up the first that spring. The only thing that was added was the beer and wine, which was, I think, the following year. But the full kitchen, everything that was there when we opened the doors, you know, greenhouse was there, obviously, because it's been there for 20 years. So I guess other than when we added the beer and wine off-premise license, I mean, I'm just talking off the top of my head, but I can't think of anything of how the business has morphed. I think that beyond when we added the beer and wine, the leasing to Ted and starting that is really the first piece of business that's been added.
Is there a request for table service?
Hang on one sec, please. Just hang on one sec, please. Anything else, Jeff?
No.
Okay, so we're in a public hearing process, so the public gets to be heard. Okay, we don't debate with the public just yet. No. Yeah, we'll get to that. Anybody else? Any other thoughts, Jeff?
Yeah,
Phil?
So, you know, when we first opened this business, one of the primary concepts was bringing agriculture back to the area. And we did with the greenhouses and expanding that business into a farm stand was part of that process. And when Ted came to us, we simply saw that as an extension of what we were currently doing, growing hops in our greenhouses, processing it on site, and serving that end product to the consumer and our neighbors. And townspeople in Hopkinton. So for us, it was a perfect addition to what we've already began. We see this as another form of food, and we see this as an addition to the overall experience within the town. I think what Ted has done relative to the build-out, relative to his hours, relative to how excited within the store, complements what we've been doing since day one.
Okay. Anyone else? Yes, sir.
Resident of Hopkinton, Trevor Hemingway. I heard a question about light manufacturing being a change, and a question of the board would be, isn't running a hydroponic greenhouse light manufacturing? I see I eat lunch out in the greenhouse, great environment. You know, you see the grow lights, the pumps, labor, the picking of the product, the processing of the product, selling the product on site. So I just didn't really see where, you know, a new light manufacturing facility was being created. So I support the brewery. I think it's a great addition to the town. I've met Ted and all the principals. I think it'd be a really fun and great thing to add to the town, and I also think that you guys are asking all the right questions, but just wanted to voice my opinion on the question of light manufacturing. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Okay, so with that, Mr. Kamal.
Yeah, if I may, through the chair, ask Tom or Ted to respond with some form of clarity to the question that, or the issues that Mr. Sestari is raising. Having worked with you on this application for the last 2 months, I can identify what you said. The counter is downsized. You've removed the outside seating area. What can you tell Todd to illustrate your commitment to maintain somewhat a low intense pouring activity on site.
Sure. So, I respect your opinion and your concerns about this becoming potentially something that outgrows the intention of what you all or our neighbors or the community would like to have on Hayden Row. That said, I think if we make any changes, we have to come back to you and apply. And to me, we have a very straightforward proposal in front of you, which we've extended and limited to make sure that we get some real clarity on where we sit. And we are applying for less hours on a day-to-day basis, less days than any other Section 12 applicant in town. I think that shows our intent to not become a significant brew pub, if you will, or to take over the marketplace. That is not our intention. You know, our business plan, I believe you're the one who mentioned our business plan in the future, was really only to sell about 15-20% of everything we make on site. And right now it's 100% of what we make on site because we haven't started distributing yet, because we wanted to see how this turned out as we finish the year here. We do not intend to have table service. Our intention and vision planning with Jeff and Phil in Waterfresh Farm was that there'd be shared common areas with a terrific environment, just like the current facility offers, where people could bring and sit down with their food and enjoy a flight or a pint. And that's, we're going to be closing up shop at 8 o'clock, 7 or 8 o'clock, 6 o'clock, I think it's 7 o'clock on Sundays. And we don't intend to have long lines or doing any of the other things that you might be perceiving that we're trying to position for, because we're not. We're just simply trying to really meet the requests of your community, which we had over 1,000 customers in the 4 weeks we've been open. 80% of them have asked the question, which we are here discussing tonight, is when will you be pouring and when can I have a pint here? I can tell you that there's been just an enthusiastic response from this community and a strong desire for folks to enjoy craft beer in this town. The craft beer enthusiasm and motion, movement, if you will, across Metro West and all of the country, Boston and so forth, is alive and well here in this town. So I think that having a brewery in town that doesn't pour would be a remarkable exception to what's happening in the state and in the local towns as well.
I'd just like to add, given that we all know the dramatic change Hopkinton has gone through over the past several years, not here, if not at this location, I don't know where something such as this business could go in town. I think, to speak as a resident of the town, that it's a perfect fit for what's there. And you have three perfect gentlemen to make sure that it's successful and not become a black eye for the town.
Okay. What's the capacity of the tasting areas?
39 is the... We have 26 seats, 39 total in the tasting area. There's the rest of the marketplace and its capacity, and there's that shared seating area just outside that room where I believe we have 15 seats today.
I'm sorry, could you go over the piece you were just saying about the rest of the marketplace?
Sure. So if you come into the property on your right-hand side, there is a tasting room, if you will.
Yep.
It has 26 seats in it.
Okay.
There is a small 14 feet by 10 feet area, 140 square feet, that has 15 seats in it.
And is that brewery or is that marketplace?
We are demonstrating them on our floor plan as shared seating area. It's part of our lease to use that common area for pouring patron. No alcohol would be taken past that area into the marketplace. Signs will be erected.
That's the brewery over there. Yep.
Both of these spaces are adjacent to and contiguous with the brewery.
Anything else right now? Nope. So, still in the process of the public hearing, Mr. Kamal.
May I follow up on that question? You've identified the areas you're coming into the building to the right. Since, and I've been to your place, since the bartender or whoever is serving beer is to the furthest point of the brewery area, how much control do you have in the area immediate to the entrance?
I think we have the amount of control that we would require to. We have roughly 800 total square feet there, right? We have a line of sight to 95% or 90% of it. Around the corner, there are nine seats, I believe. Our commitment is to ensure that no one is served at the service counter that is intoxicated. It will follow the TIPS training verbatim. No underage service, obviously, and to walk the room consistently. So I believe we'll have a high level of control in that space as we go forward.
So you will walk the
room consistently?
We will walk. Because I'm concerned about the line of sight,
yep,
as well as the fact that this is very close to the entrance. As
sure.
People come in and come out, it's difficult to monitor. Yeah.
So not only will we monitor it by walking the site, we also have already instituted a log of looking out for individuals that might be trying to, either obtain alcohol, make some records of that if they are not compliant with the law. So, yeah, we'll follow the ABCC laws. We will absolutely be vigilant in checking the area. We'll be staffed to do so. I think it'll be very clear that that is an area where alcohol is to be allowed to be consumed, but nothing past that area.
Is the bartender dedicated to bartending, or are they multi-purpose and working in the brewery as well?
The employees, that we will always have two people on staff there. The employees that are in the brew house, and I'm one of them, will also be those same employees. But a shift calendar has already been developed where that is their sole job that day. So if they're on, they're out front, and that's it. So we won't be doing multiple tasks and jobs, if that's your question, running back and forth and so forth. So, yep. And our peak periods, we'll have three or four people after 3 o'clock on Thursday, Friday, and from noon on Saturday, we'll even have four people. So,
anyone else from the public? Public, have any questions, thoughts, concerns? Okay, so with that, Mr. Kamal, do you see any reason why we can't close the public hearing portion of this agenda item?
Just one last question. Just, I want to clear this in my
sure.
mind. Who's the approved manager for the site?
Me.
Okay.
With that, do you see any reason why we can't close the public hearing?
No other reason.
Mr. Nealon, do you see any reason why we can't close the public hearing?
Mr. Chairman.
Okay. So, seeing no other takers, the chair will entertain a motion to close the public hearing specifically to start on board.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion on the motion. All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, so with that, we've closed the public hearing, and now the board will debate, or deliberate, perhaps debate. See what we can't resolve. We may still come to the applicant for questions or comments, but we'd ask the public now to allow us to do our job and try and sort through this. So I've sat quiet for the first 15 or 20 minutes of this or so, and Ted, you don't want to hear this maybe right now, but I've put on a few pounds here in the last few months because I've had a problem with my foot, and I can't run like I usually run. So I'm on a beer hiatus, trying to see if that helps me kind of get rid of about 10 pounds to get my foot ready to run the marathon back to a previous agenda item. So I'm kind of taking a little time off from one of my favorite hobbies, which is an occasional cold beer. But I'm in full support of this development at this site. I don't know the business well, but I know that area well, and I frequent the store. Maybe that's one of the reasons I have a weight problem for running anyway, because I go there for breakfast all the time. And I get in there for lunch and stop by at other times. So I think I've seen the place develop quite a bit over the years. And while I recognize we're adding services, if you will, I don't see it as a real change in the business model so much as it is adding an additional service to a process that already involves a lot of on-site activity. The other thing that really jumps out at me personally when I go to the facility, when I go to the site, is it is well back off the road. And it's well isolated from the other houses in the area. If you go get ice cream with the kids, as I used to do when they were younger, to the silo there, and they were running around screaming and yelling, you weren't bothering the neighbors, Mike. You know, the kids weren't bothering the neighbors because you're a ways off from everybody. It's set well back off the road, and I think it's a pretty private spot. I think that helps sort of isolate it a little bit in the neighborhood, because you're absolutely right. It is a neighborhood now in many respects, and we advocate that when we talk about, and I certainly advocate that when we talk about the strip, the road, and the speed limit, and the concerns we have about traffic safety and everything. But I think because it's set back so far, that certainly, I think, will help in the management of the facility. And then just inside, internally, I've watched them do their entire construction of the brewery. And every day I'd go walking around back there, probably not what I should be doing, but I did it anyway. Because I like that stuff. I like to watch things coming out of the ground. And the space that we're talking about where the serving will go on, I'm shocked to hear it's 26 or 33 or whatever. It's tiny. I mean, that's 33 people standing in a silo like this, squeezed in there. It's a very, very small space. Literally, if the space is from where I'm sitting to where Mr. Westerling is, the wall, I think that's probably bigger than it really is. So it's a very small space. I don't see, as it's laid out now, I don't see any way you could put a lot of people in there and turn it into a big, you know, literally a big beer fest bar type setup or culture. So I think for those reasons, and the willingness of the applicant to invest in Hopkinton, and I think the response from Hopkinton to the applicant, I think it makes sense to give this a go. Nothing we do with respect to alcohol licenses lasts forever. Nothing we do says that we give this license to this guy today, that he has it for eternity. And we can always revisit things. So I'm a big proponent of giving this a shot. I think, like everything else they've done in that facility, I think it'll be handled well, tastefully done, and I think, with the personality of the owners of the facility, which is a very steady, even-keeled approach to business. So that's why I feel very strongly about it. With that, what other deliberations do people feel they need to share or ideas?
Well, not to forget the last time that they were here for it. They had a pretty heavy neighborhood presence that came up and spoke for them. So they had, I know that the Director Butter across the street, Mr. Sansonetti, yeah, came up, and he owns three or four of the properties right around there. He spoke very highly of it. And a lot of the people came up, and they spoke very, very highly of it. Not just in the future what we do, but how it's transformed that neighborhood. I knew it when it was an apple farm. We used to pick apples there for whatever, when we were 10 years old. And
authorized picking of apples?
Perhaps. I grew up in that neighborhood, as a matter of fact. So it's a nice little, like, dare I say, mom-and-pop operation. I like that it's not a big industry. I like that it's kind of catering to a niche that Hopkinton wants based on its on the approval rating, but from its customers, and the fact that they're going to, you know, continue on and try to keep their business thriving and bring some industry to Hopkinton, I think that's a great thing. So much for many of the reasons that you said that you're in favor for it, I'm also in favor for it.
Okay, anybody else?
my only confusion comes in that when you're saying that the business model hasn't changed. I remember a few years ago at town meeting, there was a warrant up for changing the zoning to allow for weddings and other functions, and it failed the town meeting, and then went for the ZBA and came through at the ZBA. So my only concern is that now we do have the that some of the abutters coming up and say it's okay. But what gives me pause is that at that time in front of town meeting, it did go down that people didn't want that much of an expansion to happen. Well, that expansion happened through the ZBA, and then the beer and wine happened. I believe that also came through the ZBA. Beer and wine. Did that come through the Board of Selectmen?
I think it came through the board.
Okay. Those are just my concerns that I love that again, as Mr. Sestari said, that you want to invest in the town and all of that, but now we're talking 39 seats, even though it's a small area. Again, it's a great thing to have, and I was just in the stores as recently as Saturday buying a fortune of health food, even though I don't look it.
So noted.
Thank you, sir. but that's just this. I'm just wondering. Why that just a couple of years ago at town meeting an expansion failed, and
can we address that?
So it's the board's turn now to kind of deliberate this a little bit. We might entertain you with some of this. Okay. Anything else?
My only worry is the same thing that came up before. Now this extra shared 15 seats just really close to the door. When we're always coming down on a lot of the liquor establishments, and you, Mr. Chairman, are the staunchest.
I'm the biggest pain in the butt there is. I know
when it comes to this stuff, and even when Bill's was going to change the shape of their bar, you were very strict about making sure it was separated from the eating area, and that they were going to have a half wall up there, and then that they even put the glass on top of that. I'm surprised that you're not not coming down as you normally would. So now I'm feeling badly that I'm.
We haven't got to the enforcement part yet.
Okay.
We're still talking about. Well,
we're still
doing.
But I'm even just talking about the shape of the building and the layout and all of that. Normally.
So, are you suggesting that the slight change in the layout might make you more comfortable?
If we get rid of the shared space, I'd be closer to supporting this.
Okay.
But people leaving that main tasting area when there's not somebody over in this shared area all the time, that's going too far in my opinion.
Okay.
And I'll be honest, even the tasting room thing, I still have the same concerns that I voiced before. But you're absolutely right. These are approved on an annual basis. While I've never heard of any in town being taken away at the annual renewal, there is that ability if members of the board felt that it was necessary. I have no question that Ted has the best of intentions here, and everybody has the best of intentions here. It's just one of our jobs is to try to safeguard for the future as well, and also protect the intent of what people were putting into place. So, but again, if we got rid of that shared space, I'd be much closer.
Gentlemen.
If you're saying that approval is contingent on removing the 15 seats in the shared space, I'd like to talk more about the shared space. We have two high top tables and one four top and fixed furniture in that room. It is a smaller than most coffee shops that you walk into.
Mm-hmm.
The capacity for a brew house is one third of any brew house within 10 miles around here. This is a tiny endeavor. I understand understand the concern about access and movement through that space, and what we're proposing is putting up a split rail fence with an entry into that space, so that it's very clear that that is a separate space. All right? So the seating I'm very passionate about. I'm more than happy to talk to you about how we partition that so that you're comfortable with that being separate from the marketplace. But the just the seating and capacity is we'll spend more money with crowd control and making people wait outside to come in, to be honest.
Well, you see, that concerns me right there then.
Well, for 20.
What do you think the idea of a split rail fence to clearly?
I don't know the area well enough. I've been in there several times, but I can't say that I know the exact spot and what a split rail fence would look like there and accessibility.
It would look really cool. I can tell you that, and it would fit right in with the motif of the barn. Like, just forget that for a second. Yeah, but it would look cool.
But
in terms of safety and the passage of alcohol out of that space. And the passage of alcohol being slipped between the split rail fence, some kid on the other side. Those are the kinds of things that I think are concerns that we have to sort out somehow.
Well, Mr. Chairman, would you have allowed just a little short fence at Bill's?
So I don't recall the specifics of Bill's. I know it's laid out like today. I wouldn't have allowed anything if I wasn't comfortable with it, or I wouldn't have voted if I wasn't comfortable with it. So eventually, obviously, I got comfortable with it because I voted for it, as do I think some of my colleagues on the board today.
Oh, absolutely.
Businesses evolve. Mm-hmm. Businesses change. We all work for businesses that evolve, that put up additions, that do all kinds of different things. Any business that stays stagnant in America today is just that, stagnant. So I think we have to recognize market conditions as we deliberate these things. You know, and we don't control the marketplace. We don't control customer tastes. We don't control a lot of things. We do control the safety and the confines of these businesses, these alcohol-related businesses in particular. But to suggest that Water Fresh Farm was put in place to grow plants and that was it and it can't evolve, I don't think that's fair at all, because we all work for businesses that do just that. And we've approved a lot of businesses in this community that have evolved, and we've approved a lot of changes over the years. It's very similar to this. The Bills one is a great example of it. I mean, there's absolutely, I mean, I go into Bills too much too often probably, but you can go to Bills and stand at the bar, and then you can walk over and order a sub, and you can go back to the bar. I mean, it's not going to be any different at Water Fresh than it is at Bills today. And how they manage that, what they do on site, is what their license tells them they can and can't do. And if we catch them doing something wrong, as we get into the enforcement of this, maybe later,
Bill's is a restaurant.
We're going to talk about that.
The Bill's is, to his point, Bill's is a restaurant.
A different business.
It was already, Bill's was already a bar.
Bill's was a pizza joint when I moved to town, and it evolved.
Okay. But again, to Mr. Nealon's point, if not there, where? Again, we are talking about a residential neighborhood. It is still a residential neighborhood.
Well, I also don't think that I understand what you're saying about the underage drinking but Ted and his company have a whole lot more money invested than the liquor store next to the Dynasty. And unless the culture has changed immensely, I can't see an 18-year-old kid going to Water Fresh Farm and saying, hey, will you sneak me a growler so I can get out of here? You know, like I could see him going, not that I'd ever done this as a younger kid, but go into a liquor store and say, hey, can you get me some Schlitz? But I don't see that this place being the place where these high school kids are gonna swing down and say, hey, here's an extra $10 and you grab me a pint of fancy beer. So I can bring down to the boat landing. I don't see that to be at all.
I don't think the underage thing was actually voiced. So I think that
I think some people voiced it. I think it was said that about handling.
I think
things
Mr. Hurd.
I did.
I think
I
Mr.
Hurd
did. Yeah.
Okay. So it was voiced.
And that would be a big concern.
But yeah. I think that it's a safety and control thing overall. It's not underage versus of age. It's also people having too much and things of that nature. Having everybody, and I think that eliminating the shared space, if you got a beer, you're in the tasting. dining room, then okay, they're all in that area, in the view and control of the server.
But another point is that Ted and his company have a lot more invested in the brewing part of it. That it's not, I don't think it's up to us to make sure that they make a promise to us that they're going to be flawless. It's up to them to create their air of safety and to follow what the town's requirements are. And if they screw up, they're going to be held accountable. And if they screw up and they're held accountable, they have the ability to lose a whole lot more than a liquor store. If you shut a liquor store down, they sell their liquor, their stock to someone else, and they go somewhere else and open another store. He's got an entire brewing area there that has cost, I don't even know how much. You're in the, you do it on a household basis.
You're assuming we have cameras with audio also where we can prove that
there will be no audio.
Let's table that debate for a few more minutes, all right? So, you know, I don't mean to pick on you, Mr. Catino, but we have approved the HCA in neighborhood. We have approved the 110 Grill in a neighborhood. We have approved Quattro in a neighborhood. Every time we did an approval on I haven't finished. Anytime we did an approval on any one of those developments and the liquor license, we had people in the audience saying, that's my neighborhood. What are you going to do to protect my neighborhood? The HCA is a half mile what we're talking about. We just approved the HCA to have 200 people 30 times a year for all kinds of events.
Cornell's?
I don't understand why we're focusing on this is a neighborhood and this barn set back 200 feet from the road is such a sore point. We got to be consistent in what we do.
Right, and the HCA took us 6 months to get through. We didn't just...
I think we're on three or four with this one. It's a lot smaller.
The second time it's come before us. Meeting.
So we're just going to send them packing just because?
No. We're voicing our opinions.
Discuss it. We're not all supposed to. This is our discussion.
It's democracy, Mr. Chair.
I'm familiar with the concept of democracy.
Great.
Right.
Yes.
And sorry.
If I may, at this point, the board is focusing its discussion on the area adjacent to the entrance. I am sensing perhaps two options. There's the option that Mr. Sestari has offered, namely eliminating the area in question from the licensed area. The alternative perhaps can be addressed, and I'm offering this to the board for your consideration, in the following manner. Number one, that there be a clearly defined physical barrier. Number two, that there be an on-duty employee who's responsible for overseeing the area. Number three, that there be confirmation that the entirety of the area in question is visible from the counter in the event that the employee is working there is going to the bathroom or doing something else. Number four, if at all possible, that there be a sign that is posted clearly identifying the limits of the alcohol area as distinct from the entryway coming into the store. Again, these are two options I'm offering to the board for your consideration.
Okay. Any thoughts?
Did you say that was two options?
Yes, one being.
I thought I heard three or four.
One being if the area is eliminated. The second option is if the area is not eliminated, what are the controls that can be in place? And I listed about four instruments that we can utilize as conditions.
Well, you know, the way I'm looking at it is if the second, you know, I'm first saying just get rid of the shared space and lock down the tasting room. Either that or redesign the shared space to make it one side or the other. You know, because just move those doors around a bit and move the walls the same way as we asked other establishments to do.
Yeah, have the shared space beyond the tasting room side of the walls.
I'm sorry.
I'm confused.
I don't understand.
So these walls here that are, that's somewhat solid here.
So the walls that are going into the to the tasting room, yeah.
To here.
Just make the tasting room. There's,
cannot do that. There is brewing equipment on the abutting that wall. That is
sorry?
That wall that separates the brewery and the tasting room cannot be moved.
No, the walls from the shared space into the tasting room. So if you brought the doorway into the tasting room out to where the split rail fence is proposed to be, you're basically just making the tasting room bigger and making the...
I'm sorry. Now I do understand your comment. Thank you.
So there's a door going into your brewery right there, so you right. Put the wall on the other side of that door.
Yeah. Thank you. I do understand the comment made now. I apologize. I was thinking of a different wall.
It just gives a better line of sight, and you give, have more control just like you would in a restaurant. Or
and then you're just locking down serving inside that tasting room and not in the shared space.
Those doors that you're talking about me moving out 10 feet... Okay. That's an 8-foot wide entrance. There's sliding barn doors. It's not just a door in.
Right.
It's not a closed room. It's those are 8-foot. That's a 8-foot wide entrance. So you're talking about 3.5 feet of non-visible space on the far ends of that room in terms of the length of the corridor out into that space. That's one comment I would make. So
it's as much about closing off that area, though, from
I
the
understand.
Rest of
right. So, and I'd like to reiterate something that Norman said were new options. They were in my proposal very clearly that we would have signs and that we would have a fence, which would be a partition, making it crystal clear that this is a separate area and no open alcohol may be taken from that space. And so I think your two options, if you will, were already part of the proposal. And we were expecting to do that.
So Mr. Catino is doing an excellent job reminding me what a pain in the butt I was when Bill's was setting up the bar separate to the restaurant next door, and I was insistent upon a knee wall, I think, and maybe a glass piece above the top of that, whatever it was, to truly separate the two spaces. And I think that's to your point, right? Is that fair?
Exactly.
So you're right. And I think based on what my colleagues are saying, if we can truly delineate the tasting space by either moving walls or eliminating entirely the shared space or some combination of the two, but I don't think there's much of a combination that would work. They want to have it all in one space. I think you'd have a much better likelihood of moving your business forward tonight than on a future date.
I've been a patron at Bill's a couple times since I've been in town. Trying to visualize the partitions you're referring to and the height of those, I'm very agreeable to that. I don't think closing from the ceiling all the way down makes that space appealing. I think if we could have a 4 or 5 foot partition all the way across, that's what I'm asking for. But if am I hearing
the only problem I think there, and I do know the space. Well, is so you're at the bar,
correct?
End of the tasting room,
yes.
And that wall is up that you're describing. Let's say it's a 3/4 wall, 4 foot high wall, or something like that. That makes it hard to get around or jump over anything.
So,
but it goes still goes around that corner.
That's right.
And that going around the corner piece will be, I think, still an issue.
So
if there's any way we could do, and I think the Bill's thing was 4 feet high or something like that, a 4 foot wall. Yeah.
And then he's got the glass. In
and then you turn the corner and go back to the tasting room wall so that Jeff now has two tables or a table in that little nook, if you will, that's not shared space, that's restaurant space or that's eat breakfast space, and then everything else is inside the tasting room.
Yeah, I'd have to hear that again.
Yeah,
but
no, I'm following you. Yeah,
I understand what you're saying. In the seating room area, if basically cutting that room in half where half of it is eliminated from
shared space, but
I have line of sight to everything through my double doors right now. It's the seating. So you have 24 feet by 10 feet wide, 240 square feet there. I take 120 of that by extending or by just eliminating any and putting a partition that runs that basically cuts that room in half.
Yeah, Ted, let me just try this with my colleagues here. So here's the tasting room right now. Mm-hmm. Okay, here's the bar down here, and there's a high top over here, and I think there's a high top over here. Right? Something like that. Then here is the door into the brewery, and this is the brewery over here. Okay. This is the shared space with the chairs around it right now. Okay? And he has these really cool, funky barn doors right there that are big and heavy. What I'm suggesting, to be consistent to your point about the bills, and he's talking about split rail fence here and here to sort of delineate this. But you're standing here, you're not seeing what's going on over here, or maybe you can see there's tables here too, right? You're going to see here, but you're not going to see over here. So if we put a 4-foot wall here and turn it 90 and bring it over to here like that, and then put a 4-foot wall there and bring it over to that wall there, you would then have entrance in. You could have a little couple spaces here for him to sit and hang out outside the tasting space, and then the barn doors into the tasting space.
Then you're consistent with your other rulings, Mr. Chairman.
Okay? So.
The only limitation,
Scott, I'm sorry. I'm using your license here to do this work.
Yeah, with these doors, this really becomes almost a non-usable area.
Well, I think he will be able to get a table into this corner, probably, knowing the space, like right there. You know, it's going to squeeze you down. I think you could get a table out here, maybe a little counter area or something out here. We would like to see this wall be a meaningful wall. Would 4 feet work?
4 feet is about, four feet is about what? This?
So 4 feet is...
This is 30 inches.
Here. Yeah. Almost like, you know, high counter slight. Like.
Mr. Chair.
Mr. Kamal.
Respectfully, I think I'll discourage the board from trying to draw floor plans at this point. One suggestion would be to work with the plan that's provided. You see, the wall that comes back from the brewing room, starting from the grain room towards the entrance.
Basically here. This is restaurant.
I don't think we're changing anything.
What I'm suggesting is if you draw a new wall here, you are changing the area. But there's this wall that comes all the way up to here.
Right.
Continue the wall from the all the way to the entrance here. Maintain the same exit as you have here. Then they have this area that they've designated for.
But then his landlord loses their shared space, or the landlord loses his space.
And he doesn't have the vision again. Also.
In that corner, we don't like that one corner.
Would they?
So here's okay. Let me try this. And you're right. We're not architects. There's other things to consider here in terms of access and egress and all that stuff. Would the board entertain a conditional approval of the pouring license with the understanding that the applicant and the landlord work together to redraw the confines of the shared space in such a way as to meet the board's concerns with lines of sight?
And it doesn't get approved until we approve it anyway. I'm just going to say this is kind of our idea, and then it's approved as long as you do that, and then let them go off and do it without coming back.
No, it would be contingent upon them redrawing it to the point that that corner is removed. This corner is removed as a seating area, and that a sufficient wall structure of some kind be installed here to contain this being the other space outside the tasting area.
All right, but we need to define sufficient. I don't want these guys to, you know, be going through what they think is going to get approval and then all of a sudden say, oh, you know, we thought that 4 feet would be good, and now you guys are saying it's got to be 4'3".
You're also,
I would like to think we wouldn't go from 4 to 4'3".
Well, regardless of what we think, is it amenable to the...
Right, the we're going to have to come to that, too.
Because if it's going to cut 14 seats out of his 43, then what's that, 35%?
Yeah, we're now down to talking about creating walls for 4 seats.
Yeah.
So... I have a question that may solve this, and would video cameras and surveillance back in my bar area of that space meet the monitoring concerns you have?
Well, would it be high def video, and would it have?
No, I mean, not for me. I mean, you know, I mean, I think those are good for historical and you know, seeing what happened after the fact, but. I wouldn't want the bartender spending their time, you know, watching the monitors when they have all the bulk of the people right over here in front of them. You know, like I said, I think for me, to Mr. Kamala's point, there's elimination of the shared space, or there's bringing the walls back so that the shared space is inside the tasting room, as opposed to presenting inside the grocery store, the farm stand.
Well, for me, I'm a big fan of innocent until proven guilty, and they have a whole lot of everything staked into this business, and if they make a mistake, they're going to be held accountable. But if it meets everything legally, then I have no problem with it as it sits.
And I like your drawing.
Okay.
I just have to stay consistent because I wouldn't want somebody else to come back and say, you made us do it and didn't make anybody else do it.
I understand.
Because it is more than tasting. We're talking about pouring pints.
So if you like that drawing, then, and you would be okay with that drawing, then the only outstanding question is, what does that wall look like compared to what's there today, which is basically nothing. What do you want? Do you want to?
I want something where the space it's more. It's part of the tasting room, so it's contained within the tasting room.
So one of my thoughts is, as I go in there all the time, as I look over and I see what's going on down there, and I can see down into the tasting room, I can see the big tanks in the brewery area, what have you. And I think that helps the business marketing, you know, the traffic flow for the business, that people go in and say, oh, what do I see over here? That's cool. You can see at, you know, the average height of 5'6", you can see over that 4'6" wall or whatever that is to see what's going on. So if we could kind of nail down what the height of that wall is and then do a conditional approval, and if they don't meet that height or wall, or they come back and say, we can't do it, then we throw it all out. I'm just trying to move it forward. We tend to languish in things sometimes in town, and... would a 4'6" wall with maybe shelves on the inside where they could drop their, you know, put the beer on the inside, but you can't see it from above, you peek the wall or something like that.
Oh, there are going to be ferns on top of it?
I don't know. They grow a lot of stuff there.
The weeds from the lake.
We could take the lake weeds. It's true.
Pretty soon there can be other ones too.
Yeah, that's right. Oh, God. What do you think?
And work with that.
Okay. Gentlemen, if we take the tasting room as it is today and come north, right, because that's coming north out of the tasting room into the current shared space, and put up a 4'6" wall or whatever. Scott, what's the appropriate half?
That sounds about right.
4'6", thank you. A 4'6" wall that does not allow beers to be stuck on top, okay? So you got to do something with your design to keep people from putting a beer up there. But you can put a shelf on the inside because you're inside the tasting area. Would that be amenable? You my drawing? It's highly
technical. I think, do you mind if I see your drawing, Mr. Chairman?
Sure.
I think I understand what
you're saying. Scott, Mr. Coutinho has a question for you, Scott, if you don't mind.
What wall did you put up in Bill's, the separation wall?
Did you do Bill's?
Yeah, what was the height? I think that was about 4.5 feet, and then the glass above it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Sorry, Tom. Can you just...
Then I'm...
That's the bar. These are the high tops. This is where the tables are
basically
now.
Basically where you were talking about putting the
talking
fence.
About putting that wall there.
It would be a wall.
I understand. Is the concern visibility or just a clear partition so people understand that there's a clear definition of where the space starts and stops?
Yes and yes.
Yeah.
Partition.
And visibility that the bartender can see what's going on and not on the corner. It's no greater.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. But I don't think the height of that wall is affecting the bartender's view. It's just affecting the bartender's view into the...
Into that corner. The corner is gone.
I'm down to
one chair, two
seats right here.
So now everything is...
This is what
it's
in that
round.
I can't believe I'm the heaviest.
This can't be nothing.
15 or
something.
I don't want to be
there than anybody. For... These doors open up, there'd be nothing there.
I just have 227.
An entry here. Yeah, I'm sorry. Can I take 2 minutes to discuss this, please? Thank you. So, you know, we're looking...
So, Mr. Tedstone, schedule-wise, and I'm sorry we're running over here.
This walkway...
What's your... You go okay for a bit here?
Space. I'm going to have...
We have another...
This space here, I am going to have 6 feet by 10 feet. I'm going to have room here for 8 seats.
Okay.
That's it, because I can't use any of that. And I can't use any of that.
Suggest bringing some more tables in here.
How about you can't use it on the side?
Well,
it's not the easiest thing to do.
It's very hard to predict.
Right. I all I can do is put in the seats here. So
let's just be done with it. Just take that.
Yeah.
Come back.
But there were others that were given 15, and we went through.
Yeah, so
five.
We had the late thing kind of.
I know. That's just not. Yeah.
So the agenda, that lands right here. That's... If there's an issue, do you have an issue with me on that? Because
one of the problems is if you're overestimating, then you need a lot more meetings to get the business done.
Right.
Yeah.
All right.
So because you're not going to keep scheduling.
I'm sorry.
Ready.
We have our applicants back.
Yeah, I don't see the removing the sunken costs in the walls that we've already created and the high level of concern that you have. I will no longer pursue the shared seating areas for alcohol, for serving beer. I've used alcohol a few times. It's just malts, my own malts. That's it. So I told you when I first came in that we were hopeful to bring the patio into this space at some point. I will be before you again next year. Perhaps we'll speak about the shared space at that same time. But at this point, it'll just be the 39 load and the tasting room itself. I'll update this diagram and remove that shared speed. Seating from my application.
Okay, so let me just repeat that. You're saying that right now the application includes shared space outside the tasting room. You're going to take that off the table and that will not be included in the license that we would issue.
Because I understand that the selectmen might not approve it if I keep it the way it is.
That certainly appears to be the case, yes.
And so, therefore, I will remove it.
Okay. So, any other questions or concerns, if that's off the table?
I mean, you know, I've already voiced my other concerns, but I'm willing to, you know, move forward if that's off the table.
Mr. Coutinho.
I'm ready to move forward.
Yeah, I'm good.
Okay. Jeff, Phil, you guys okay? I get it's not ideal. Okay, counsel, Mr. Kamal,
all set.
Okay,
so just one more question. So, if they come before us with a plan next year for the patio, will there be some type of consideration given that, that they've given back to us and a little bit of leniency and try to work with, not leniency, but try to work with them so they don't get stonewalled again?
That will be the determination of the board.
I don't like the term stonewalled.
Yeah, I don't
want to
think
that
we didn't do anything different than we have with every other restaurant.
Okay, well, this is my first time going through it, so
this is what the public expects, is that we're going to look at everything and
we gave
and
we give everything
the chairman
a shot in your words and
you what?
A fair
I
shake.
Remind the chairman of how tough he normally is, because we really do, and that's the hard part for Mr. Cesari also. You know, it's the hard part is we love the establishment. I love going there. It's a great place. However, we just have to show the same consistency that we do with everybody else's alterations.
Okay, so that will be a question that comes at that time, and we'll just have to deal with it then, or the board, whomever sits at that time, will have to deal with it then. So with that, and at the risk of causing further confusion. I hope not. The chair will entertain a motion to approve the application for the...
Well, do they have to come back with an altered application before we can approve it?
No, I think we can do it with a condition that be removed from the application.
That's okay with Mr. Kamala.
Yes. The board can approve the Startline application for the pouring license. With the revised floor plan as discussed tonight. My only concern is with the 15, with the chapter, with the section 15 license for freshwater farm, because their floor area perhaps now changes.
That doesn't impact our floor space.
Okay, then the board can vote with it.
Okay, in the past,
could I have my
past,
agenda back, please? I'm sorry, the paper there with the, had a technical nine.
I thought we had had discussions in the past, and we were told that we could approve a license as submitted, or we could deny it, but we couldn't have a contingency within the license. I'm wrong. That's fine. I'm happy to do this as long as we're all, you know, on the level and legal. I'm happy to get this done so that Ted can, you know, start his business.
Yes, my comment is based on the assumption that there's a clear understanding regarding the revision to the floor plan.
There is, if I could help clear that up, there are two spaces clearly discussed in my application. We have just eliminated one of those spaces. Okay. It is sliced right down. You cannot use the shared space outside the tasting room. There's a tasting room and then a shared seating area. So the shared seating area, the diagram will be updated to not include that in my application.
So then I think, based on that comment, Mr. Kamala, the chair would entertain an appropriate motion specific to Startline Brewing Company approving the Farmer Brewing Pouring Permit License under Mass General Law Chapter 138, Section 19CN, submitted by Edwin Twinney of Craft Life Brewing Company, DBA, doing starting business, Startline Brewing, 151 Hayden Row, with the full and complete understanding that the shared service area, as shown on the floor plan, will not be included in the licensed area.
So moved.
Second.
Mr. Kamala, are you okay with that motion?
Yes.
Mr. Nealon, you okay with that motion?
Okay with the motion, Mr. Chairman.
Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carries. So we need to see a revised floor plan as part of for the file that does not include that.
Understood. That has to go to the ABCC from your office, so it'll be here tomorrow.
Okay. All right. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Item number 10, ladies and gentlemen, I apologize for us running over, is a posted public hearing that we opened earlier that we will now continue as quickly as we can, specific to alcohol policy changes. Mr. Kamala, can you give us the specifics that we're looking at on this agenda item?
Yes, through the chair, I will refer the board and the public to the draft alcohol beverages license document, which which has track changes, and I'll walk the board through the changes section by section. Under definitions, we have attempted to answer the question that the board asked, namely, were there any other permissible alcohol licenses under Mass General Law that we did not have in our books? And this was in response to what had happened with the BYOB case, where they came in, and because the board did not have any regulations, they went in without any appropriate permitting by the to restate that there was no permitting required for that use. And so here are the licenses that we are proposing to add to the policy. Auctioneer's liquor license, BYOB, which is bring your own bottle. Charity wine license, this is a temporary license. Charity wine auction license, this is also a temporary license. Charity wine pouring license, this is also a temporary permit. Charity partnership wine pouring license, specifically this is an instance where a particular organization works in partnership with an entity, and this could be an entity here in town. And then there's the continuing care retirement community license. This is a relatively new license. It's a license that the two retirement communities in town could apply for, namely Golden Pond and the new one on East Main. And so that's the umbrella of the licenses that we believe the board should add to the policy so that we avoid the situation that happened with the BYOB.
Do we want to take these one at a time or in groupings, or do we want to do the whole thing at once? It probably makes sense to do them in groupings, I think.
Yeah.
I don't know if we want to tie this discussion of those additional licenses to a later discussion about...
Mr. Chair,
there's one.
Given, I'd just like to say, given the hour and what we still have left on the agenda, I'm wondering if this can wait until the next meeting. I understand that these are things we want to get out in front of, and we'll just have to cross our fingers and hope that nothing comes up in the next 2 weeks where we could have used this. But again, just for the sake of getting through the rest of the agenda, there are a lot of people waiting here to talk about other issues as well.
I'm confused. You want to talk about meaning the tabling the additional licenses piece?
Yeah, tabling that piece.
But go to the later piece, which seems to draw a little bit more attention.
Yes.
I got you. Yep. Mr. Kamal, can we move right to the issue in front of us that seems to have the most interest in town?
Also skip this issue?
The video and audio policy.
Okay.
And what we're going to do is we're going to come back to the alcohol policy. We're going to continue this public hearing. Anyway, let's just get to the video and audio thing, and then we'll figure out how to do it.
Okay. I refer the board to page 8 of the draft policy. This is under section
F6.
Just want to see the lettering. F6. Sorry, thank you. Security cameras. By way of context, what is the problem that this is intended to resolve? The problem is simple. From a public safety viewpoint, it has been very difficult for the board to prove that a specific seller has processed or sold or saved an intoxicated person. And again, this discussion has come up strictly from a public safety viewpoint. What we are suggesting is build upon what already exists, not in terms of our policy, but in terms of what package stores have on the ground. Most of the package stores do have security cameras. and we are proposing that all licensees shall install security cameras that record continuous video footage. I just want to underscore that point, because in the past we have had instances where we have data that is provided through time-lapse cameras. So under this policy, we're suggesting that there be continuous video footage. The number and position of such cameras should be adequate to capture each point of sale from the perspective of the employee as well as the customer. We have also included under this provision a requirement for audio recording. In terms of context, again, it's been very difficult for the town to prove that a seller is selling to an intoxicated individual, and so one suggestion that has come up is to record the conversation. This aspect of the suggested change has drawn the most attention. What I have heard in terms of the comments that we have received include the following. There are privacy concerns that have been expressed. Other comments have pointed to civil liberties concerns. And in addition, one of the comments that has come up is that the town only has had to deal with two instances, so why is this policy being extended to apply to all establishments? What I'm offering today to the board as a compromise is that rather than making this a blanket requirement, the board could reserve its right to require audio recording in the instances where there is a violation. So in summary, this is the security camera related issue that board says we should discuss up front.
Okay. So we're going to try and tackle this one issue, this one piece of the puzzle tonight with respect to alcohol policy changes, because we've obviously got some folks here that have spent a good part of their evening waiting for this. So Mr. Kamal, help me figure this out, though. We're in a public hearing process. We're going to try and tackle one piece of the puzzle. We can go to the, we can have a little quick discussion here, then like we typically do, then we can go to the public and get their information. And then when we start to repeat ourselves, which I think is going to happen in about 3 seconds flat, we don't need to repeat ourselves beyond that. We can then come back to the board and see if we can't try and get this one piece of the puzzle decided. We can make decisions inside the public hearing and then continue the public hearing for the other stuff, correct? I'm just trying to make sure we keep our public hearing process intact.
There's nothing wrong in the board building a consensus view on any aspect of the policy as you move along. Yes.
Is the board okay with that? What I'm describing here is that we're trying to do one piece of this inside the public hearing, but not close the public hearing.
But we can't vote until the public hearing is closed.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Well, could we vote inside the public hearing? No.
I would recommend against that.
Okay.
But there's nothing wrong in the board building.
All right. So we have two questions in front of us, video and then audio. Okay. Today, video exists in Hopkinton at these establishments, correct?
In most of them. From our
most of these establishments, video exists today. Okay. It not only exists for public safety, but it exists a business practice in that people watch what's going on inside their business, they watch what's going on at their cash register, etc. So there's the video question, and I think the policy says get the video a little bit more up to date with modern technology, correct?
Yes, and also eliminate the time-lapse cameras.
Okay, and then the second question that I think stirs a little bit more of an interest is adding audio to the video in these establishments.
Correct.
Okay. So those are the two questions that we want to talk about at the moment. We don't want to talk about anything else because it's 10 o'clock and we've got other stuff to do, and this will be enough, I think, as it is. So everybody good with that? Yep. Ladies and gentlemen in the audience, everybody understand what we're trying to do here this evening to help you guys be heard in a timely fashion? Everybody agree with what we're talking about doing here? Everybody good? Okay, great. So with that, let's go to the board first real quick. Video and audio, Mr. Tedstone.
I like the video. I don't like the audio. I don't like the thought that it would make it impossible for an employee to work at a place like that, that says everything they say is being recorded. And for the amount of infractions that we've had, I think that this is complete and total overkill for the issue at hand. I'm fine with asking people to upgrade their video. I'm fine with making a requirement to update their video, but I think audio is a bit too much.
Mr. Cadino.
I totally agree. I don't want the same reasons that it would be a burden on the employees, that they wouldn't be able to they'd have to bite their tongues the entire day. And then what happens to these recordings? Who actually has control of them? Could some of these recordings end up on YouTube? Could they end up in court cases? Could they, you know, who controls them? Everything's information nowadays, and information is so easily disseminated to the entire world in a matter of seconds. So I'm okay with the video because it's proven. Many stores already have it. The upgrade to the equipment I'm okay with, but no audio at all.
Mr. Sestari.
Yeah, I'm pretty much in the same camp. I'm fine with requiring an upgrade to the video, or at least establishing standards for the video. The audio, you know, I think that a lot of people talk about this in terms of taking away the customer's rights. I don't really agree with that, but I do agree with the fact that it's the employees who are there all day. If a customer walks into a place and says that they're being recorded from an audio standpoint, then they have due notice there, and they don't have to hang out there all day. Whereas, you know, to your point, you know, working an 8-hour shift and making sure you don't say anything negative about your boss.
It'd be impossible, you know, for me and you.
You know, I think that it is frustrating. It is frustrating, you know, coming to a situation such as we have in the past where, you know, evidence seems to be pretty darn clear that infractions do happen. And when you get parties to agree, in premise to, the penalties for those, and then all of a sudden things come out and, you know, it's, well, you know, there's no audio, so you can't really prove it. That's the frustrating part. And that's, you know, so the public knows that's kind of where this comes from. You know, do we want to find a way around that? Absolutely. You know, do we want to do something that basically puts a muzzle on employees of liquor stores, you know, for a full day, every day? No, it's not something that we're after. You know, we can think of something else along the way, or, you know, maybe there's something else that happens along the way in terms of technology, but this doesn't seem to be the right move.
So just to be clear, and perhaps to reiterate a little bit of what Mr. Sestari said, we're not doing this and we're not considering this because we just decided we'd make it more difficult for people in town to do certain things, and we want to be big brother and listen in on everybody and do it. Something happened, folks. Something very serious in Hopkinton happened. And as a result, we took action. And as a result of that action, without having specific information and evidence, we weren't able to follow through on that action. So we're not doing this in a vacuum. We're not making it up. And we're not trying to be draconian in our policy making here in Hopkinton. We're responding to our role as public safety officials to make sure we're looking at and considering everything possible for public safety. So please, some of the information I've seen and some of the emails I've received have suggested that this is our wish list. This isn't our wish list. This is a reaction to a very serious public safety situation where people could have been hurt or killed. So keep that in mind as you think this through. So I've been on this board a long time, and counting votes is a very easy thing to do. So it doesn't matter what I think. I think we already know where we're headed in this process. So with that, I come back to the board and I say, okay, how about Mr. Kamala's fallback position that if an establishment from today forward or whenever it is we put this in place has a violation, and that violation is upheld, if you will, do we then consider putting some form of audio and video system in place to make sure that that violation doesn't happen again?
I would say no, because as evidenced by our last episode where it was overturned by the ABCC, I don't think that without the audio you're going to get a conviction, so it's kind of a moot point. I don't think that, I think that moving forward that they're going to fall back to these rulings and we're not going to get a conviction.
So with even with a violation by establishment, you're still not in favor. Mr. Catino.
And I concur that if you're saying that we get a conviction, if you may, using the video already, then that meant that the video worked.
Okay.
Oh, well done.
Mr. Sestari.
Yeah, no, I was going to make the comment that Mr. Catino did. I would like to just clarify that there wasn't anything that was overturned by the ABCC, but we were advised against pursuing, certain actions. If we're saying that it has to be ruled official that there was a violation, then we're in the same spot as we are today. There may be cases where, because we don't have audio, we can't have it deemed a violation, or we don't want to pursue it for that sake. If we were going to say that it was dependent upon us to determine that there's a violation, and that's the trigger that gives us the authority to say they need to put in audio, I'm not sure that I want us to be in that position.
Okay. Mr. Kamalo, any thoughts before we go to the public?
I would like to say I'm interested in hearing your opinion, though.
I count votes very quickly, so it doesn't matter what my opinion is. Mr. Kamalo.
No further comments.
I'll tell you. I will tell you. Yeah. Any further comments?
No further comments.
Okay. I like the fallback position Mr. Kamalo suggested, but I count votes, so I'm not going to push it. I think if somebody makes a mistake, because I'm a pain in the ass about these, a pain in the butt about these things quite often in town, if somebody has a violation and that violation holds, then I think another punitive step beyond the violation should be, we're going to now video and audio what's going on in your store. But I can hear what my colleagues are saying, so we're moving on. Let's go to the public. And get their input on this piece of the puzzle with respect to alcohol policy changes. Who would like to address the board specific to the issue? And I'd ask that you keep your comments to 2 minutes or less, and when we start repeating ourselves, I'm going to encourage you to move along. Mr. Richardson.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman and board members. You received my letter on behalf of the Hopkinton Chamber of Commerce. Basically, we had gotten quite a bit of feedback from some members and actually some people who I never heard of, and we actually discussed this at one of our board meetings, and we were very much opposed to the proposal. While we understand it's in reaction to an occurrence or other occurrences and you're trying again to look out for safety, we really had an issue with the audio recording proposal. Likewise, on the video, continuous video component. Again, we don't want to impose, again, a lot of additional cost, expense, and so on these businesses. We understand most of them do have video surveillance, obviously for their own safety and for the employees of the store. So again, I would defer to hearing from owners of stores on that, on their aspects relative to the video aspect.
Great. Thank you very much. Anyone else? Hi.
Hi. William Goldberg, 2 Oliver Lane. I'm happy to hear the discussion before you open it up to the crowd here. I just want to say I think it was a good decision because, first of all, was it just package stores or would you include beer and wine licenses, and then would you include pouring licenses, especially where they're directly assisting patrons in the consumption of alcohol. And if you went that way, how would you do that? Would you have to have all the servers wear body cameras with audio recording? So, and what about special one-day licenses? I think it would have been a very slippery slope with a lot of regulations. So I just think the way that most of you were talking about it was the right way to go. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Sir, if you would join us here, please.
Sure.
Thank you.
Trevor Hemingway, 91 Main Street. A question was, is there any data that the board has considered that would show that this potential civil liberty issue would be effective? You know, are there other towns that are already doing this now, and you've analyzed the data and said, you know, hey, this is a way to go, or is this somebody's idea that, hey, this would be a good thing to do?
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Name and address, please.
Ron Clark, 8 School Street. Good evening. I have a question. Does your proposal apply just to package stores or also to bars and restaurants that serve alcohol?
It's my understanding that the proposal under consideration is for package stores.
Package stores only.
Mr. Kamal?
Correct.
Okay. Well, I would recommend a couple of things here. One is that I think that the board should not do either one of these requirements, video or the audio recordings. I think you need to let business people manage their business and decide what's right and appropriate for their business, which they have the investment in. And, you know, it's unfortunate that there was a couple incidents here in town, apparently. Two's too many. One's too many. The problem you have with trying to wrap the community in a bubble of regulations is you're never going to remove all the risk. There's always going to be risk out there. And that bubble of regulations is going to end up being a thicket to strangle the businesses in town. And really, I think your job is to look at how can you help business, develop business, grow business, and putting more regulations on them is not going to do this. And I think the step back and think about how can you do that. And you know, your public safety logic here is flawed if you're only looking at package stores where you can have the same exact issue with the bars and restaurants. And so I would say step back and let businesses run their own business and let them put in this equipment if they think it's best for their business purposes. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? All set? Okay. So we've heard from the public on this piece of the puzzle, and it certainly doesn't seem like there's any kind of consensus for the board to move forward with this change to our alcohol policy. So I think we'll be tabling this as we continue forward with the other aspects of the policy changes. Mr. Kamal?
No further comments.
Okay. Anybody have any final comments on this piece?
I mean, I guess I didn't hear it as black and white as you did. I got the impression that there was an appetite to continue discussion about requiring video surveillance with upgraded quality. Unless I missed something when I was out.
You're absolutely right. I'm in my brain focused on the audio side of this right now.
Now, all that said, I do think that we're probably not ready to act on this because I think one of the key components that would be missing from this is any type of recommendation on how long the video needs to be stored and maintained and things of that nature. So I don't think it's something that's ready for action right now. But but I think it's something that we should still be discussing.
So there's two pieces to under consideration, really. There's the audio and there's the video. Video is required today. It's not as extensive as what could be, but there is some video requirement today, and I think that's ABCC regulated, correct? So video exists in our world today, and I don't know if the town necessarily is going to move away from video. Perhaps the type of video is the discussion point, and there is some investment that would be required if we went to a more enhanced video. I guess I was thinking in terms of audio.
I apologize.
That I think that audio is something that, while we won't formalize it tonight because we've got some other work to do going forward, that I think that that piece is off the table. Is that a fair representation? Mm-hmm. Everybody agree with that? Okay. So with that, we're going to continue this public hearing on alcohol policy changes to a future date. There are other aspects of it that we need to consider. I think we've tackled the one that stirred the most interest, at least given a very, very, very good indication of how that piece will play out. And then we'll come back to the others very soon. So that public hearing is continued to future date and time. Item number 12, town manager's report. Mr. Kamala.
Very quickly, two items that I would like to share with the board. The first, that the negotiations with E.L. Harvey are now complete, and we are poised to sign a five-year contract with the following costs. Year one, $631,400. Year two, $647,000. Year three, $663,200. Year four, $679,760. Year five, $696,800. In total, this is 3.318 million 160. The contract, the five-year contract, represents a saving of approximately $65,000 from the numbers that the board last saw. So, in terms of implementation, we're hoping that the recycling bins will be in place by end of January.
Mr. Kamala, when we went back and forth with E.L. Harvey and Sons and had a lot of discussion around this potential contract, there were a lot of promises made, and those promises were the concern of many, including my colleagues on the board. Are you confident that the promises made by E.L. Harvey are in this contract for signing?
Yes.
Okay. Anybody have any questions to Mr. McCullough, for Mr. McCullough? Kamala about this question.
Makala, you just made him Irish.
I'm just a puddle. Mr. Tedstone, anything?
Nope. As long as all the guarantees that were given to us are being followed through, I'm fine with it.
Mr. Catino?
I'm fine with it.
All set.
Mr. Kamala, anything else?
Yes. I'm requesting the board to authorize the town manager to review the asset naming policy and some observations to the board at your next meeting. Here's why. When the board adopted the asset naming policy, the focus was on naming town buildings and assets strictly from the viewpoint of protecting the town's culture, town's history, and so forth. As currently constructed, the policy does not account for instances where there is a sponsor who would like to sponsor a town building and be granted naming rights. I have received, in my tenure here, I've received at least three inquiries in that regard. This first came up when we were working on the library project, specifically with the fundraising effort. There were also questions that were raised during the celebration of the town's 300-year anniversary. And most recently, this topic has come up in my conversations with the Park and Rec Commission. So tonight I'm advising the board of these requests and the need for the town manager to review the asset naming policy and determine if there's an opportunity to respond to the request to look into sponsors
of town projects or town activities receiving naming rights.
Does anyone have any concern or questions to Mr. Kamalo about looking into this asset naming policy?
No, I don't have a concern about him looking into it, but it would have to be pretty well spelled out for us moving forward. I mean, the last thing, I don't want the DPW barn to be sponsored by
Caterpillar,
Weetabix or something, you know? So yeah. It needs to be kind of, yeah.
Okay, so we didn't have this as a specific item that we were going to discuss tonight or deliberate upon, so I think the best thing to do now is just to either yay or nay the town manager looking into the asset naming policy and report back when we put it on the agenda at a future date. But to deliberate or get into sort of a dialogue tonight probably wouldn't make sense, and I don't think it's really appropriate given the agenda that we've put forward. Okay? Thank you. Okay. You okay?
Yep.
All right, so do you need a vote from us to do that, Mr. Kamalo?
No.
Okay, I think everybody's in support of checking it out and trying to figure out how to move forward. Okay, future board agenda items. Anything else? I'm sorry, Mr. Kamalo, anything else?
No, I'm all set. Thank you.
Future board agenda items.
No, we're going to say parking again.
Yeah. Okay. And I hear you.
Okay. Is that eight in a row?
Can we put 30 minutes on the next agenda to discuss where the town is with central parking in the community, central downtown parking in the community? We need Dave Del Torio here, John Westerling here, and ourselves.
Yeah. A couple of points. We are planning to come back before the board to update the board on the Main Street Corridor project. And I thought our response all along has been that when we do that, we will cover the parking issue. The other piece is there are several options that we're looking into that do not lend themselves to open discussion because they involve real property.
Okay, but we could, without getting into those details, talk about generally where we are and where we're headed with parking in this downtown area, right? So I think I would rather we, because he's been reasonably patient about this topic, he wants to talk about it, let's give it 30 minutes. It is critical to the community. And let's just get an update without spilling the beans about what we're trying to do sort of on the negotiation side.
Okay.
So that would be December 22nd, if at all possible.
Oh, 22nd.
Okay. With that, the chair will entertain a motion to adjourn. Any discussion? All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Good night, everyone. Do we have anything?